Good morning, friends. I'm so happy to be back in the church again this morning after a week's handing my coal back to the devil every few minutes. Every time he hand it to me, I'd hand it back to him, and we're still fighting. I'm just determined he has to keep it. See, every time he hands it to me, I just push it back to him. See, he hands it to me, and I push it back to him. So he's good on handing it back, though, you know. He certainly knows how to do that, but we'll finally wear him out or wear his patience out. As I said the other night, a fellow said one time he was prayed for, and he said, well, said, the devil told me I wasn't healed. And said, I looked down and said, all my symptoms is there just like they were at the beginning. And he said, well, I said, Satan, that's true. I don't see any difference. But you know what? Until they leave me, I'm just going to testify as hard as I can for the glory of God. So now if you want to stick around and listen at me, just stay around. That's real faith. Testify to the glory of God, because faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. You don't see faith. You just believe faith. And this week, been pretty busy up the house. And of course, the first day, I think it was around 30 in. And all my interviews and things coming. It's been a very busy week. And I've learned some things this week. I went down and I got a friend here in the city that's a very fine fella. He's a medical doctor. We went to school together, Dr. Sam Adair. And he's just a swell fella. And so I haven't seen him for about 4 years. I had about a 3 or 4 hour talk with him this week. We went out to the office and just shut her up and went in and talked. And I was rehearsing to him some things that I'd found out spiritually about powers of evil and how they come in. And he was telling me the medical or the diagnosis of it in the medical terms. And it's surprising to see how perfect those hits together. So he was telling me about a certain mucus that comes into the human being, of where that a man don't have to carry a coal like or anything. Said it's just a mucus comes in there, and then the germ gets into this circuit mucus, or this mucus makes the germ. I said, well, if the mucus makes the germ, then I would like to know where the life of the germ comes from. Well, of course, that he said, we don't know that. He just can't tell. You get a chili or something other, and that germ forms in different forms, and it has a way of multiplying itself. And just keeps putting off germs from this mucus. I guess a doctor, somebody would be by, or a nurse would understand more about it. But my interest was, and my thoughts was, that germ itself, the life inside of that, inside of that little cap, like a little capsule, so teeny the human eye can't even see it. But inside of that teeny thing that only a great powerful glass could see, inside of that is a life. What causes that life to take so much of that mucus and fold itself around and make this capsule, see, or germ? That's the devil. That's spiritual power. That they'll never be able, they have got down to a place even below the molecule, that they could pick up this little germ cell and so forth, and the little teeny membrane mucus that could only be seen through a powerful glass. And then, but beyond that, they can't see, because there's no natural substance to take a hold of. Now, before the people standing, Charlie, I hate to see you and David and Rodney and all of you there. You so good to me when I come down to your house and things, can't give you a seat in the house of God, but I tell you what I do. If you'll come right here, here's mine. Come right on up and just make yourself welcome. Any of you that wants to come right here and take this seat, just walk right on up here. See, you'll be more than welcome. And it's a good one. It really don't belong to me. It belongs to Mr. Wilson, the head of school. I've had it since 1937, over so he's here sometime and goes, hey, you still got my chairs? I said, I'm sitting in them every night before preaching. He said, well, that's good hands, man, so let it go. Now, you're welcome. It's one seat here, and then if you just like, come here where the little fellows are sitting. I said, don't let that embarrass you, think you're a little fellow, because you're not. But you like to be again, but here's one more seat they're sitting out here, and there's one over here. And so you might be able to, especially some of those ladies, there that's kind of standing there like that. Thank you. And we'd be glad if you come right up here and sit down. It'd be all right. Just put your arm right around, lean over as we talk. Charlie, I thought you'd come up this way. I've teased him all the time. I said, you come up to church. I tried to get him to come see me. And I said, when you come to church, I'm going to say, this morning, Dr. Charlie Cox will have the message. And walk away. He said, I'll faint. But before I called him, he stuck for the back room. So I would like to just, before we start in on the lesson, I thought last week that the Lord did bless us. Did you like the my, it's just swarmed everywhere. Even that message has got all the way into California. This calling last night out of California from it. And now they're wanting to set up and have the same thing in California in the next coming month of January. See, the Holy Spirit just seemed to strike all at once right there at Shreveport, and it's just going from place to place like that. And just an hour of revelation. And so we're so glad and trusting and seeing our own group here at the Tabernacle so prospering by this, seeing the manifestation of God among us here. We're so happy for it and believe that we're at that great hour of the calling out of the church and setting it in order. So I was finding something that while talking to my good friend, Dr. Adair, sitting in his office, and he said, was talking about different things, about x-rays, and said about bad colds and different germs, and reaching up and getting his books and showing me through them what they find out. He said, I'll tell you, Billy, said, as a bad cold, so many of them said, we haven't got one thing for a bad cold. I said, well, I always thought that if you got a sore throat, if you gargle something, I said, now, after I get through preaching, I said, go home of a night, that little horse, I said, I get some Lavaris and gargle it. I said, we've had it in our house for years and years, mouthwash. He said, cold water would be just as good. He said, because don't ever think that anything you could gargle would ever do you any good, because only thing it could do is just wash what germs in your throat out. It can't get down into the bloodstream. If it does, it bursts your throat and you'd have a hemorrhage, see? And said, can't do that. So the old saying comes back again. Medicine was made to sell, not to take. And after all, and seeing in medical books that I even have at my home to read, I'm interested in medicine. Certainly am. Anything that'll help God's people, help human beings. If it's peace, studying peace terms, I'm interested in that. I'm interested in a better community to live in. I'm interested in better schools for our children to go to. I'm interested in anything that's good, wholesome, and right. And medicine has done some great things. I believe God has used it, many things. I believe we'd be more sincere and consecrated to God that already have stuff for cancers and everything else. If we just, God got the thing, if we just asked him about it. Yeah, now I believe the reason the salt vaccine was just because of little children suffering the way it is, and Satan, that evil thing out there, paralyzing them little children. And God just let that be discovered for the inoculation. And it's done a great thing, and to which we are grateful to Almighty God for it. Just so thankful that God has ever blessed us. And brother, where he ain't going back home, is he, Sister Nash? Oh, that's good. That's fine. Mm-hmm. All right. Now, in studying, then after I come home, I sat down there in a room and studied for a long time. What's this all about? I'm going to pass a little something to you that I'm studying on that you might study with me. And the Lord, when I was in the room, I take it to be him, because I have had some great experiences with him. But did you know that after the doctor told me that and showed me in the highest and latest of medical books, which I know that I just discovered there's a doctor sitting here anyhow listening to me. Now, this, the latest and best things for a bad cold, they have no medicine. They condemn taking aspirins and so forth. That only eases the pain as so forth of the cold or the misery. But it don't do the cold any good. But it helps rest you. And the best thing for a bad cold is lay down and go to sleep. Take it easy. Just lay down in bed. That's the best thing you can do. Now, then I got to studying. I said, Dr. Sam, then this is this a bad cold, the best thing is take rest. He said, it's the best thing for anything. Well, I said, thank you, doctor. That's awful good. And we talked a while longer. And then I went home and I told him he likes rabbits and squirrels and things. Don't get to go out. We used to hunt a lot together when we were boys and hunt fish, or fish especially. So then when I went home, I got to thinking, what, you know, I noticed, watch animals. You take a dog when he gets sick, you'll go drink him some water and lay down somewhere. Go lay down. Well, then the thought came to me the next morning. I was laying in bed waiting for the folks to get up about 6:30, and so I wake up about 4:30 or 5. I was laying there thinking, many times God reveals things. You know, I don't teach this, but did you know man in the beginning when God made him, he didn't make him to be doctored. He had his own doctoring in him. He was a unit of his own. See? Then healing does not come from any outside resource. It has to come from the inside. Now we can take outside aids, such as to kill germs or whatever it is in us, or we can take our hands and cut on each other and take a piece out, or something like a appendix or a bad tooth or something, and take it out. But healing does not come from anything that you apply. Healing only comes by the power that's within yourself to build back the tissue that's been torn from the place that's been taken out. And therefore, healing is in you. Now, listen close and think hard now before you pass your thought of this. Man in the beginning, when he was made, a man is a god. He's absolutely a god. For he was made in the image of God, being a son of God. And then he's an heir of all that God is. And man was given a domain, and the domain was the earth. You have power over the fishes, over the fowls of the air, and over everything. He could just speak and everything obeyed him because he was a God within himself. Not universal God, but I mean the God of heavens and earth, but he was a ruler in his domain. He was a king ruler. That was man, and even now in his fallen estate, now he still has the appearance. Not long ago, they were trying to interbreed and so forth and say that man come from lower animals and through evolution he brought himself up. Well, see, they've kept fooling around with science till they disprove their own theory. You cannot interbreed anything and make it go higher. It'll drop right back. It cannot. Hybrid car or anything cannot breed itself back. Like I was saying the other day, the donkey and the mare horse can breed and bring forth a mule, but that mule cannot bring forth another mule. Let's go right back to the beginning. Because God said every seed after its kind. Now, when we were made, and it just found out recently, that your body is full of light. X-ray proves that. The X-ray does not have any light of its own. It's your light that it uses. You're born with four rays. After a little while, say 20, 25, one ray goes out in 35, another 40, another goes out, and finally when you get past about 65, you're living on your last ray. And every time you take an X-ray picture, you're tearing them rays down. That's the reason you don't have no more. You stick these kids' feet in them machines because it was just tearing the rays right out of their little bodies. And that's cosmic light that's in you, that you're made up full of light cells. Now, that's cosmic light. But God is a different light. But yet he's light. Now, I think that the picture there is a great proof of what I'm fixing to say. That God is light. And when we were walking in light of God as sons of God, God's not cosmic light, but God's light operated through the cosmic light of our bodies, ourselves. And we were absolutely at one time real, genuine sons of God. But then when the fall came, and then where the fruit of the Spirit today is love, joy, faith, long-suffering, meekness, gentleness, patience, all supernatural, it just got to a spot to where all the whole body, just so gradual, like a seaweed, you get in the bottom of a sea, a lot of times divers, and they'll get onto these seaweeds, and before they know it, they're wrapped in such a way they can't get out of it. Well, that's the way sin has done the human being. That's the way coldness has done the church. That's the way communists has done the nation. It's so treacherous. And then in the human body, it wrapped us in pushing out this light of God by denominations and denying faith and so forth. It's pushed out all the rays of God's great power of faith, see, that's in us, that should be. He's pushed all those rays out in such a place that we just got to a lodge, and then now below the lodge, the church is. Because it just pushed all the darkness out, and even just saying it doesn't happen, denying that it could happen. See, the miracles of God. And yet, the man somewhere down in him, somewhere in him, if he could only let that little, as I illustrated it, like a button. When a man say that much of him is God. That's the little light that comes in to make you quit doing what's wrong. Now, if you can take all the malice and envy and strife and unbelief out, that little button-like of the light and power of God will keep growing, 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 crowding out unbelief. And you don't do it by exhortations of bodily exercise. You do it by a sanctified, consecrated life that the Holy Spirit moves through you. I caught some of it in a place where not long ago, how many ever remembers when Lige Perry was raising the dead that morning? Some of you over here, you've seen the paper here many times. See Sister Wilson, I'm raising her hand. I was standing there when that man died. He lives right out here now. Comes to church once in a while, testifies to him. He'd been dead several hours. He died with hemorrhages of the lungs, and he was so bloody all over, and I walked away. I was just a young preacher those days. And Sister Jackson used to be a member of the church here, and a Methodist preacher's wife, I forget what that man's name was now, Schaffner, Brother Schaffner, Sister Schaffner. There were some relations to the Wisehearts, and she was standing there at the bedside, and I started to move away, and he was just as bloody as he could be, where he died, and his eyes had turned back, and his throat pulled out, and they pulled a sheet over his head, and his wife was out there, and they're crying and trying to get addresses to call the loved ones. And I started to walk away from the bed, and I felt somebody lay their hand on me. I thought it was Sister Schaffer. And when I turned, there was nobody around me. And then I started, it left me when I turned around, and Brother Lige was laying there dead. We'd been very good buddies, fished on the river, you know how they did so much together. And he got hurt, I hear, a railroad riding a spider. Well, it mashed his lungs in. He bled and tucked TV from it and died. I started to move away this way, and then I felt that hand again. I turned back, it would get off of me. And before I knew what I was doing, I was laying on top of that man with my lips against his lips. I was as bloody as he was. Laying there on that man, crying out to God. And I felt something come up around the side of my ear. It was his hand. You've heard him stand right here and testify, see? And he come back to life, and that's been about 25 years ago, or maybe 30, living today right out here on the curve. Amen. And it come here not long ago, was testifying of it in the church. Amen. Now, that's where Canada called up and wanted to know one time. I testified of it in Canada when I first started my meetings. They called Mr. Coots, the undertaker, and asked if there had been a man raised out of the parlor is dead. I've got the clippings yet. They said, we've heard of many miracles being done, Mr. Coots said. And said, Mr. Branham is a personal friend of mine, and all kinds of things have happened. But we have no record of anyone being raised out of the dead, especially in this funeral parlor. The Canadians had misunderstood. And the next day, the paper was lined up. He said hundreds of people called from everywhere, and Brother Perry and himself testifying to the resurrection of his body over there and protesting the thing that he had put in the paper. And so Then it was understood it wasn't there, it was taking place in his home. And so where he was laying dead, they'd never taken him to the funeral parlor yet. Then I read the other night of where Irenaeus, I believe it was, or St. Martin, that laid his body across his friend after being hung. Now that's history. And laid on him for an hour, and the man come to life. And I see in the Bible where Elijah laid his body across a dead baby's body, and it come to life. I think of the little boy yonder in Finland when he's laying there dead, laying on the side of the road. Then, about two months ago, I believe it was, Gene, in the Newsweek, that they turned what they call the divine healers loose in London and let them go praying for the sick, and it's about 80% more healing than it was for medicine. That prayer for the sick. Reader's Digest picked it up, and in America here, we got it wrote out here. And Reader's Digest, where they examined for divine healing, and they took a brother that prayed for the sick and had a sick man and had him praying for this sick, and then put a piece of lead foil. Anyone knows lead foil reflects that ray upon between the man and the man that was praying, the brother, his hand, and laid it down like this and shot the picture of X-ray, and from the man's hand showed a visible reflection of a ray coming out of his hand going to the other man. God knows what he meant when he said they shall lay hands on the sick. They shall recover. Laying on of hands of this man upon a sick man, and the mechanical X-ray, oh God, showing a light coming from the man's hand. How can people be so stupid to say there's no such a thing as a divine healing? Why, even the mechanical devices, the machines that science has made is a rebuke to their own ideas of these churches saying there's no such a thing as divine healing and the power of God. How about the man in Chicago, just on and on, telling how he put me before that meter there and that thing, how that hand would register like a lie detector of it, see? And that woman laying dying, put the testimony that even whirled that hand around enough power to send a radio message around the world 40 times and broke the machine down. That saint dying, making her confession. Put it on a wicked man, him dying, and when it did, it filled the hand vice versa across this other way enough to break the machine down. That infidel said, if there is a God and his goodness of a good heart to his praises would send that machine enough power to throw it around, there's something in that woman making that power. And if on a wicked man would throw it back the other way, he said, God be merciful to me, a sinner, and gave his heart to Christ. That's right. Why, science knows that someday you're going to find out God is in you.
Amen.
God himself in the human being. God in us. Oh, how I thank God for those things. So wonderful. Now, before approaching his word, and now, let's just take our time, because this morning we're going to pray for the sick. And I gave it out. And now someone was asking if we'd be here next Sunday. Well, I don't know just yet. I hardly can know unless the Lord reveals it. If the Lord's permitting, maybe next Sunday night, I'm taking all these morning sermons from my precious brother here. Next Sunday night, maybe, if I'm around, the Lord willing, which usually I am, unless I have a call out, I want to speak on, we have seen his star in the east.
Amen.
And has come to worship. See, just a message, a Christmas message. And now, before we approach him, or his word, let's approach him by prayer. If all that can stand, let's stand just a moment. Our Heavenly Father, we are the most happy people that... We get so happy till our human souls cannot contain it. We just have to scream out sometimes and give vent to the joy that's in our hearts through Jesus Christ. To know that in the hour that we now live, where everything is in the turmoil that it is, yet there is a foundation that's sure.
Amen.
And to see smart man who's rose up in the days gone by, and has tried to disprove that God even existed through their own mechanical device, it has come right back and testify to the glory of God. truly Judas had to say himself that he had betrayed innocent blood. The Roman centurion said, truly, that was the Son of God.
Amen.
His own enemies had to testify. And we've lived to see a scientific age come to its end. They can't go no farther. They're going to just at any moment blow each other to pieces. And yet we see that the very scientific machines that they invented to try to disprove you turn right around and testify of your glory.
Yeah.
We thank you for that, Lord. Let us today remember that God's word shall never fail.
Amen.
Give us faith, Lord. Is that little rude expression a while ago that I made about the power of God being in us and all of our fibers to be light of God, and darkness and sin has choked up the little pores in us of our soul? Let the Holy Ghost this morning spread forth in our being, pressing faith out into our innermost being, that our whole bodies and lives will be so saturated with the power of God till people will see that Jesus Christ lives in His church. Stand it, Father. We commit it all to You now and ask that You will bless these few words that we're going to say now to try to comment on what has already been written by one of Your apostles, the great Saint Paul. And I pray, Father, that the Holy Spirit will take this and just let it grow out through the hearts of the people to give faith for the oncoming healing service. We ask in Jesus' name, amen.
I say unto thee, my people, this day, as thou hast assembled in the house of the living God, that thou might worship me, I speak these words unto thee this day, by my Spirit, saith the Almighty God, that I shall visit thee this morning in a great and mighty way, for thou shalt see and behold the demonstration of my power and my Spirit in the midst of thee. And I speak unto my prophet this day, as thou uplift these words of faith, yea, and as thou exhort my people that they should put their trust in the Almighty God, I say that I shall be mightily with thee this day, and thou shalt be delivered from thine affliction, saith the Almighty God. And I speak unto thee, my people that are afflicted, that in the days that lie before thee, thou shalt behold the hand of the living God outstretched in a great and mighty way. And I say that I shall do great and mighty things in the midst of thee. I shall lead thee in many strange ways that thou hast not walked heretofore, and thou shalt behold the workings of the Almighty God as never before, and my might and my power shall be greatly demonstrated in the earth throughout the nations in the midst of my people. For I say that the hour is upon my people that they should demonstrate these things, that the world may know that I am the Almighty God, and that I am rising up by my great and mighty power, and I shall vindicate my truth, that the Almighty God.
Thanks the Lord. Amen. Hallelujah. Praise be to
God.
God, we thank Thee for Thy goodness and mercy. We thank Thee for Thy manifestation of love and power, for all that You have done for us. We are unworthy of the blessings that you give us. I truly, by the sound of the message, it must have been the same self-message that went forth and seemingly was calling to sinners to seek you, for the hour of destruction is near at hand. Father God, we pray that if there be that person here this morning, or those persons that would understand that we know nothing of these things, that it's truly the Holy Spirit speaking through human lips to give the interpretation, to call the people that was ordained before the foundation of the world to be sons and daughters of God, and may they shun this for a long time. May they come today, Lord, to know Thee and to find that hiding place, for the hour is close at hand. Grant it, Father, as we wait on Thee further in the message, in Jesus Christ's name. Amen. Now, if there would be someone who might not exactly understand how the messages go forth that way to them, it might have been that one missed saying something that the other one picked up. Or you know how little the other, small the other one was? Just a few, maybe the other one left off. And when the translation came, it came all in the same line. See, that brought the message out. A calling to the sinners that... It just happens to be these people don't know what I was going to speak on. There's nobody knows it. Not no one in the world knows it till just now. But that's the very thing that I'm talking on. Yeah. Now turn with me to 1 Corinthians, the 14th chapter. It's good to just let get all the unbelief out of you, so that the Holy Spirit can come in and just take its way, you know, and move right through your fibers and control and control your life. Now, you just take it down scriptures. I noticed the other day the kind of teaching along helps so much. So I've got three or four pages here on what I'm going to speak on this morning of scriptures and things that you might take down and mark the places. And I've got them marked down here so I won't forget them. Now, in the 14th chapter of the 1 Corinthians, 1 to 8 verses. Listen close now. Follow after charity and desire spiritual gifts, but rather that ye may prophesy. For he that speaketh in an unknown tongue speaketh not unto man, but unto God. For no man understandeth him, howbeit the Spirit, in the Spirit he speaketh the mysteries. But he that prophesieth speaketh unto man to edification and exhortation and to comfort. He that speaketh in an unknown tongue edifies himself, but he that prophesieth edifies the church. I would that you all speak with tongues, rather that you prophesy, for greater is he that prophesieth than he that speaketh with an unknown tongue, except he interpret, that the church may receive edifying. Now, brethren, if I come unto you speaking with tongues, what shall I profit you, except I speak to you either by revelation or by knowledge or by prophesying or by doctrine? And even things without life give us sound, whether it be a pipe or harp. Except they give a distinction in the sound, how shall it be known what is pipe or harp? For if the trumpet give an uncertain sound, who shall prepare himself to the battle? Now, I want, when you go home, just continue to read that full chapter there, because there's many verses of it, 40 verses of this chapter. And I want you to read it when you go home. It explains the gifts. Now, if I would call it a text this morning, what I want to say is the uncertain sound. Now, Paul here was speaking on speaking with tongues. If there be no interpreter, who would know what those people said a while ago? They wouldn't know. But he's just speaking to God. Surely his Spirit's giving out the word, and he's glorious. It just blesses him. He said he edifies himself because he has the consolation of God speaking through him. But if there come an interpreter along with that thing, an interpreter comes behind that, then it don't only edify him, it edifies the whole church. It gives everybody the word of the Lord through that. Now, but he said, if there be the prophet, then, the prophet speaking so that the entire church, which is a prophet, what is it? A divine revelator of the divine word, that has the revelation of the word to give to the people, then that edifies everybody, you see. Now, the man who speaks in tongues could speak in tongues, and it's forbidden for anyone to speak in tongues in the church unless there be an interpreter there. So that's the reason that we are permitted here to speak in tongues, because we have three or four interpreters right in the church now. Right now, right here with this church, interpreters of unknown tongues. And therefore, if there was no interpreter, then we would not permit them to speak in the church, however, at home and when they're praying, because they're edifying themselves, because the Spirit is up on them until they're trying. People actually think that they're saying what you can understand, but they don't know what they're saying. They're just like standing up and start saying something, and you just can't stop it. It just keeps flowing out. And they think that they're speaking where you understand. It's a subconscious condition. Just like when on the platform, like today, you'll notice when the discernments come, there's many people in here I've never seen in my life. What's the Holy Spirit when it comes down? Well, begin to go out to the audience and tell those people who they are, where they come from, what happened, what disease they got, all that. See, what is it? It's the Word of God, sharper than a two-edged sword, piercing to the marrow of the bone, and even a discerner of the thoughts and the intents of the heart and mind. It's the Word of God. Now, Paul said, if you all speak with tongues, there be no interpreter, unlearned come in saying, they're crazy. Mad. The word mad means crazy. And I say, they're mad. But if there be one who can prophesy and reveal the secrets of the heart, then everybody will fall down and say, God is among them.
Amen.
Now, if they be an interpreter, an interpretation to an unknown tongue is a prophecy. See? It's prophecy itself. Because the Holy Spirit's speaking, and it gives the interpretation to tell certain people certain things to do and everything. And each one knows when it strikes you, you know who it's talking to. And so it's good to see that it's not only, it ain't human beings, it's God in the human beings that's doing His work. Greatly, we sure do thank the Lord for it. And I begin to notice that it's beginning to come into other places, churches. Charles Fuller, how many ever heard the old-fashioned revival hour? Great man. He says not long ago, he said, we have the speaking in tongues interpretation right here. Right there in Long Beach. And that's true. I preached right there with him many times. So they have the interpretation and make everybody sit quiet. The thing of it is we don't reverence those gifts. And then sometimes if a gift gets out of order, you have to call it down. It's Satan trying to push him overboard. If he can't keep a truth from you, he'll take that same truth and push you overboard with it. See? That's right. He'll make a fanaticism out of it. See? Now, we try to keep it straight here. It's beginning to move up in our church again for the first time for years. So we keep it straight to let them know that when many times, like right now, there may be somebody just feeling like speaking in tongues, see, right now. But they're supposed to hold their peace. See, I've got the word now.
Amen.
And then after this is all over, and the altar call or whatever this is finished here, then a message can go forth. You see, the speaker can speak with them. Or before this time. Now, if it keeps on getting on and gifts coming in, then we'll have a special time for them to meet. And they'll meet together hours before the church ever begins and sit together and prophesy and speak with tongues and write those messages and put them right here on a platform. When the pastor comes down, he'll come right out and say, thus saith the Lord. If it shall come to pass the day after tomorrow that Brother Jones, living over here by the railroad track, move because it's going to be a car fall off track and mash his house. Thus saith the Lord, there'll be a woman in here this morning named so-and-so. She come from a certain place, and she stole something when she was a girl. Brother Branham or Brother Neville or who it is, she'll lay hands on her after she confesses her wrong and will make it right. She'll be healed. Her name is so-and-so. See? And the pastor, before it ever takes place, the service, she'll read these off. Amen. Right. See? Now it's in a baby form among us now. See?
Amen.
In a baby form. Then you see, there's nothing can slip up. See? See, the devil will get in and just start in the flesh. Then he does, he'll tear the whole church to pieces like that. See, he'll just go into fanaticism and carry on any time, you see. But the church is in order. See? And now if a person has got a gift, and then he's called down by the Scripture, and they fly loose at it, it shows it wasn't a gift of God, because any gift of God will respect the Word. That's the reason divine healing is such as it is. See, and the Holy Spirit respects the Word, the Holy Ghost, the baptism in the name of Jesus Christ. The Holy Spirit in you will respect this Word because He wrote it Himself, see, and He's in you. That's that light of God that's in you that will honor the Word regardless of what the Word is. The spirit of the prophets, the prophesiers, gifts are subjects to the prophets, you see, which is the divine revelator of the Word. Now, and aren't we happy to see these things in our day?
Yes.
Now, this is a day of uncertainty. It said here, if the trumpet gives an uncertain sound, who shall prepare himself for battle? Paul speaking here, of course, he's speaking to these Corinthians, and many of them are soldiers in those days, in the Roman army. Now, if the trumpet gives an uncertain sound, who shall prepare himself? You got to have the certainty of anything. We got to know whether it's right or not. And now we're living in a day of great uncertainty. We all know that. The day of uncertainty and the time of uncertainty. I don't believe there ever was a time since time first began, back in the Garden of Eden, when sin come in and broke eternity into time. I do not believe there's ever been a space of time with so much uncertainty as today. Because there's not even one hope left in the natural world today. Now you say, well, I've seen times and read in history when the wars covered the earth. That is true. But never a time when the whole earth would be blown to pieces just in 1 second. See? And such a destruction would take weeks and hours and so forth. Now it takes 1 minute. Maybe not that, just a button press and she's all over. Stop. And they don't have, Cuba can do it herself. They don't have to, a little bit, Haiti's could do it. Just any little nation that wants to can set the world completely on fire and blow her out of her orbit anytime they want to. See? And it only takes one fanatic, or there's tens of billions of them around the world, to do that. What's some suicide case? Just reach up there and be among there, and the devil's so possessing this. Where these big hangers are hanging, just press that one button, here they go. And as soon as that goes up, it's in the radar screens of others, they press theirs, and here we are, see? That's all, because they've just got, every fellow's got his screen out watching. Out in the sea, submarines, out on the islands, everywhere sitting around, up in the North Pole, down in the South Pole, everywhere, with these big screens, just let somebody press the button. That's all they want. And here their button's pressing, the rest of them pressing, 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 what's going to happen? But oh, the think that that could happen before we get out of service this morning. But remember, before that happens, God has promised to come for His church. He's promised to come, so we don't know just what time He will come. What a glorious thing!
Amen.
To all those that love His appearing, He will appear. Don't you? Wouldn't you love to see Him this morning?
Amen.
As we sing that little song, I want to see Him, look upon His face, there to sing forever.
Amen.
All His saving grace. When all life is over and troubles and sorrows have flown for the last time, and we see Him, and there we stand, young, immortal, forever in His presence, where there will never be sin, sickness, heartache, sorrows. When all time will fade into eternity, what? What a glorious thing. And then what does that make you do? Want to work now to get everyone in that position that you can for that rent. I've reconsecrated myself, and I promised God that I'd try to do a double potion. I've done everything that I know how to do, and I just wish I was a young fellow again, 18, 20 years old, and know what I know. How maybe I could stand up a little longer, visit a few more, or something like that for the kingdom of God's sake. You young people this morning, it's young, got a lot of youth in you yet, and not family ties and things. May God let you see the vision.
Amen.
To see what hour
Amen.
We're in.
Help.
The uncertainty. Let's just look over a few uncertain things now. In this uncertain time, There is uncertainty about being, we spoke of war, there's uncertainty in the voice of the warlord. We can't understand. They don't know. You go and they'll have big meetings and so forth and they just can't get together. There's uncertainty. They don't know. They don't know what's going to take place. All the greatest strategists and so forth are studying war and the possibilities and how this would come out. They don't have the answer this morning. There's nobody does. They just can't tell you. Well, science after all the great things that they could think of. All the great strategy that they could go through. All the scientific maneuvers and switches they could pull of their scientific machines and their great master minds and minds that think far minds. And when they got all together in this hour, they said one thing. It's 3 minutes before midnight. That's their answer. Or can we survive it? Could we dig down and get under the ground far enough to keep them bombs from getting us and survive as a nation? Certainly you could. Hell, blow a mile deep in the earth. What if you were 10 miles deep? If you would, you'd be in lava. But what if you could get that far, the concussion would break every bone in your body.
Amen.
There's no way down. The way is up.
Amen. Amen.
Oh, I'm so glad to have the answer, aren't you?
Amen.
A sound that's certain. That trumpet of digging down and going into caves. Now I hear they're moving all the government and things out here around Fort Knox and down around Mammoth Cave and got a place down there that's fixing up. That when if it comes something like a little fussing of a war or something, they're going to take the government inside of these caves. Don't the Bible plainly say that they'd hide themselves in caves? Exactly. See, they don't have the answer. So our great regime of military strength doesn't have the answer.
Amen.
Now, we used to be our science to say we could make a great machine. We got a better gun than Germany could make. We got a people's got a lot of grit and power, and the old Yankee pep and play the drums and the bugles and blow and the flags fly and a little hoorah and everything like that. Boy, we can go over there and we got the old grit behind us to do it. You don't have to go over there. This is one time we're going to get it at home.
Amen.
Just one guy has to press the button. That's all has to happen. One man. Don't have to have thousands of soldiers trained. Just have one man with no sense. Just possessed of the devil. Just to press that button and that's enough. See? So they haven't got the answer. So what did they finally come up to say? Well, it's 3 minutes till midnight. I got a film of that. It's loaned out to a doctor friend of mine now. 3 minutes until midnight. Now that film was made about 5 years ago when the Jews first began to return to Palestine. And the film there shows them bring the old cripples in on their back, walking. And they're going around interviewing them. And so when they asked him, said, are you returning back to the homeland to die in the homeland? Said, we come back to see the Messiah. And what did the prophet promise? Many of you read the Look magazine, Life, and then they had the picture of those airplanes bringing them up and down in the different places, down around and the places where they were at. And when they wouldn't get on that plane, they never see this. They'll plow with old wooden plows like they did about 2,500 years ago when the Roman Empire scattered them. And they wouldn't get on that plane, but their old priest walked out there, one of the old rabbis, the teachers, walked out there and said, didn't God tell us that someday we'd go back to the homeland on the wings of an eagle?
Hallelujah.
They laid down their plows, got on the plane and flew back home on the wings. Isaiah saw it, but he didn't know what it was. He just looked like a bird flying. He seen Israel coming back. Waving back and forth, you rode in planes know what it is. It's a wave back and forth. It's like a bird flying. Coming back home. They got out there and they said, well, where's the Messiah? They wanted to see him. And I'm telling you, when you see the Jews going back like that, that's
Amen.
God's timepiece. We're at the end. Now, just reason to become a nation, become all that they are, and got their own money and their own military and everything, their own. Everything, they are a nation again.
Amen.
See? Oh, what a beautiful thought. I've got some scripture on that a little farther down in here. Yeah, on that. Now, uncertainty of war.
We don't know what time. Listen on the radio. You hear them say on the radio, get so much stuff in your basement. Get enough water on account of fallout. Get your radio in there and take it easy. I see in magazines they're advertising little buildings to get into to set in your basement or in your yard or something. If the bombs start coming, you survive it. The fallout will get you anyhow, so you just don't have to worry. They could drop a bomb down New Orleans and the fallout will get you here. So it doesn't matter. You die anyhow. So stay in, stay alive a little longer, something like that. Oh, my, I don't even believe it. I believe it's nonsense to even try. But the church don't have to worry. You ain't going to be here then anyhow. That's one thing, sure. You're not, because the certainty of God's word promises so. Now, let's just take something else that's uncertain. Just so many things. Jobs is uncertain. You don't know what time you're working today and tomorrow. You don't know. It's just uncertainty. You have a good job, you think, and the next day the boss comes around, gets somebody else and kicks you out and puts somebody else in. So it's uncertainty of jobs. Let's take also home life is uncertain. I tell you, I don't know what's happened to the moral fiber of our women.
Amen.
Divorces on the move, it's just terrible. And you see where the divorce courts are crowded, where girls or boys will marry and live together and have two or three kiddies or something like that, and they'll separate and get out and marry another and marry another and marry another and marry another and marry another. And their homes, I was in a poor, real poor home the other night. The man said, I tell you, I just don't know. Said, I just don't know how I'm going to make ends meet. I looked around, he worked. He had a little old wife there, as true blue as could be. And four or five little old dirty-faced kids around on the floor. And I said, boy, you're a millionaire. And he said, well, Brother Bram, I wouldn't dispute your word. He said, brother, I ain't got a dime. And I said, but you got something that money can't buy.
Amen.
I said, you got a little old wife here that probably hasn't got two dresses to her name. And if she did, it's somebody gave her. Because the man just has a day's work now and then. And I said, looky here. But she's just as loyal can be. I said, there's a many a multi-millionaire tonight would give every penny he had to come home to a wife like that.
Amen.
Right? I said, his wife's out with a bunch of men somewhere or on a bar room somewhere, cussing, singing, smoking, night riding around and things like that. And yet he loves her. But look what he's got. All of his life wrapped in that woman, and look what she's doing. And vice versa, woman to man. See? So there's no difference. It's come time we're all everything is just one conglomeration of sin. Little woman at home trying to take care of her kids and her husband out somewhere drunk and carrying on rum with other women. What would she give if she had millions of dollars to see that husband really become a man?
Amen.
There's only one way for it ever be. Jesus Christ is the answer.
Amen.
You know, nothing can ever do any good. It's at the end time. It's Christ and Him alone. Now, then I said, how many little fathers that's walking around today with millions of dollars to give everything they had, if that little spastic child that he's got were just as healthy as yours this year tonight. You begin to look at me. Now I said, look, you said you had some bologna and beans and a loaf of bread that you drawed your money this afternoon and got some bread and beans for your children tonight. I said, every one of them with good stomachs and could eat it. You did too. How many, what did John D. Rockefeller say? He'd give a whole $1 million if he could eat one mess of cabbage.
Amen.
I said, you sat by the window this morning, the cold wind blowing in. Him sitting in a palace thing, somewhere. But yet, if you had to sit there and eat a mess of cabbage for that cold window blowing in, stuff a piece of paper in it. I said, John D. Rockefeller would have given $1 million to eat one time, like you can eat any time.
Amen.
How many blind men with a cane in his hand pecking along the street give every penny you had for your eyes?
Amen.
See, you can't evaluate.
Amen.
the things that are really rich with the things that we call rich.
Amen.
Now, pardon me, church members. That's the reason we're trying to say this morning, you can't evaluate your big church and your big steeples and things with the love of God that's in our hearts.
Amen.
No comparison. These things come supernatural. You may think that we're odd because you hear them speak with tongues and interpret and people cry and shout and scream. I'd rather have it than I'd rather be a pastor of a little old rackled up building like this where the power of God meets with the people, where the church comes together with those things like that, and to have the biggest cathedral there is in all the world to preach in, with a lukewarm bunch of cold, professed, so-called Christians. To have to watch whatever word you're saying. You can't preach by inspiration. You have to have it so-so, and watch every judge and every doctor and everything in there. If you want to say something that hurts your feelings because they're big payers on the church.
Amen.
I'll take the way with the Lord's despised you.
Amen.
You can't evaluate it. There's no way of doing it. So therefore today, the man that's rich is the man who is in Christ. Now say you had good sight, good health, a lot of money and everything else, but yet without Christ, you're lost. You're a wretched, miserable, poor, blind, naked, and don't know it. That's what the lady you see in church age was. You might belong to the biggest church there is in the nation. You might belong to the largest denominations, but still be lost as lost can be. See? So the rich man is the man who is in Christ. That's right. Now, the uncertainty of home life, the uncertainty of jobs, the uncertainty of war, the uncertainty of churches. Maybe we struck that. Let's just speak on that a few minutes. The uncertainty of church life. You just can't evaluate it hardly, because there is no way to evaluate what an experience in the Holy Ghost is to a membership of a church.
Amen.
See? There's no way you could buy this Holy Spirit. It comes as a free gift from God. It comes to anybody who, you say, well, let's just go to Pentecostal. Pentecostal is not a denomination. They tried to do that, but you can't denominate God.
Amen.
Pentecost is an experience that any believer can have.
Amen.
It's for Baptists, for Catholics, for Jews, for black, for white, for brown, for yellow, for red, for any color, creed, or anything. Whether you're poor, rich, got nothing, got plenty, or you're the in-between, or whoever you are, it's for you.
Amen.
And it's God's love and mercy measured out to you to take it. Don't cost you one thing. Only thing it costs you just to surrender your life to Him and receive it. How simple. Just forget all you ever know and just surrender yourself to Him. And that's how it comes. It's just receiving it that way. Denominations, it just couldn't be. The denomination gives an uncertain sound. Now let me just show you that it is an uncertain sound. You go to this denomination, they say, we got it. The rest of them haven't got it. All right, you go to that denomination, go to the next one, we got it, they haven't got it. See, every denomination, there's 900 different denomination churches, 969, I think, to be exact, according to the statistics, 969 different denomination churches, and every one claims the other is wrong, and they got it. So that certainly is a very much of an uncertain sound.
Amen.
900 and... But how does this sound? Jesus Christ the same yesterday, today, and forever.
Amen.
No uncertainty about that, is there?
Amen.
That's the way to evaluate. That's where to find where truth lays. Say, we Methodists got it. We Baptists got it. We Catholics got it. We Presbyterians has got it. Well, Jesus is the one who has it.
Amen.
Because He said, I am the light, the truth, the way. So it's Christ in you. So these different great denominations certainly is a difference. And they give a very much unreliable sound. And anything as uncertain as that is unreliable too. Anything that uncertain is unreliable. You can't depend on just joining a church and saying that's it. Because each one's given a different sound. And where are you going to? It confuses you. If there ever was a place, I have made this statement many times, I say it again this morning, the worst place they need missionaries I know of is the USA.
Amen.
What is a heathen? A heathen is an unbeliever. Well, now we have in Africa and in down in Thailand and different parts of the country, we have the native heathen that worships an idol. And we call him a heathen because he worships the idol. He doesn't know right and left hand. He doesn't know his ABCs. The only thing he knows is that's a god that the witch doctor told him of, and that's where God is in that. And the only thing he knows now is find something to eat and eat any way he can find it. Now, that is what we call a heathen. But now, that man is not too hard to deal with if you bring him truth. But the hardest man to deal with is this educated heathen.
Yes, amen.
This heathen here in the United States has got 4 degrees in college and stands behind the pulpit.
Amen.
An unbeliever.
Yes.
Say, well, we had a service the other morning and the Lord healed a lady down there. That's a heathen. He's just an educated heathen. Heathen is an unbeliever. Day before yesterday, setting up at the place, it's a group of people, some of them here now, was a little lady drove up out front. There's 5 or 6 people inside. There's a lady drove up out front in a trailer. A man came to the door and said, Brother Bram, I hate to come over to that sign there, but said, we're just passing through and want to say, I said, come in. And I said, no, I said, my wife just wants to testify, to tell you something that happened. Well, she happened to be a good friend to Sister Mercener, Brother Leo here, one of our brethren here at the church, one of the tape men, his mother. And about 8 or 10 years ago, I was somewhere in the East here, and a woman come on the platform to be prayed for. The Holy Spirit said, you are Mrs. So-and-so, and you came from a certain place. You're suffering with so-and-so. Yes, that was all true. That said, now you've got a friend that lives in California that's a very precious friend of yours, and this woman is dying with cancer of the kidney. She said, that is certainly right, Brother Branham. That's Holy Spirit revealing the secrets of the heart, you see. Should make the American people fall on their face and say, God, see, it should do it. But oh, they're educated heathen. That's the kind that's hard to deal with. See, he's so smart, he knows more than God does. So that's the reason he hybrids his corn, hybrids his animals and everything. See what he's got himself? Coming right back, making off breed of himself. That's right, by doing so. And a breed of the mind, of the spirit. He just simply gets off on it. Now, we notice that this woman said, yes, that's right. I do have a friend that's in California dying with the cancer of the kidney. I said, you write and tell her, thus saith the Lord. She's not going to die but live. And that was the lady outside. And she said, that's been about maybe 10, 12 years ago. And said, I got well, sounding well. There's not a blemish on that kidney. And she was healed. Said, about 5 years after that, I took a tumor. And the tumor growed to such an excess until it become, I believe she said, either 17 or 27 inches across it. And she was so big that she couldn't stand up with this tumor. When she tried to stand up, she couldn't balance herself. And they brought her to this church and set her down right there. And they brought her at nighttime after we'd had the healing service that morning. And the brethren here told her that we'd not be praying for the sick that night because if we were I prayed for the sick that morning and they didn't want to put too much burden on me at one time. And so after the service is over, I was standing talking to some people and some man got a hold of this woman and packed her around the house and set her on that step there as they went out. And she was sitting there, the man packed her, and Brother Taylor, one of our precious brethren here, the church is right there where when it happened, and I think helped get the woman around. Are you here, Brother Taylor? Where are you at? Back in here. He was standing there present. And helped get her around here to the back, and the tumor out like this. And so then said, when I come out the back door, just gazed down and looked at her, said, woman, Lord Jesus that healed you of that cancer of the kidney, many years ago, shall also heal you of that tumor. Thus saith the Lord.
Amen.
Never touched her nothing, just walked on out and got in the car and went away. And he said, will you come out and look at her? I said, yes, sure, tell her come on in. No, we ain't got time, we just got to go. Walked out there, and a little woman, she jumped out of the car, just as flat as I am. She had a great time out on the road. Running up and down the road, speaking in tongues and screaming at the top of her voice in front of the Presbyterian parsonage. Just having a great time. Now, some of the neighbors might have looked out and thought, well, that must be somebody of the insane institution come up for Brother Branham to pray for. That woman wasn't out of an insane institution. Her soul was just back in glory. Having a wonderful time. She said, looky here, Brother Branham, opened her coat up just as flat as she could be. She said, now for the first 2 or 3 months after you told me that, said I was so bad. And said, the doctor said he was going to go try anything more if I wouldn't let him try to take that tumor out of there. Said it would weigh better. How much did she say? Around 30 pounds, brother? Brother Taylor?
Yeah.
Around 30 pounds, they estimated the tumor weight. And said all at once, it started.
Amen.
Oh, he keeps his word. That's right. Now, if you'd like to write to the woman, we got her address and everything. She left it for Leo and to greet his mother for and things. And it happened to be that her brother married a friend of mine up here at Utica. The girl was in there. His name is Clyde Raines. He's run on many. I lie about Chisel, we call him. I played with him when he was a boy. Lives up here on the Utica Pike. Some kind of a state officer there now. And his sister was sitting in the car and there. I think, go to the Carmelite Church. I just wonder what impression that made on her. She said, Billy, it's wonderful. I used to know the girl myself. I've been out with her a couple times as young folks when we were lived up here on the road. And a very nice girl, just as fine as she could be. She's about my age now. And so she, but just sitting there, listening to that testimony. This was her husband's sister. That have been healed. Oh, I tell you, brother, there's no uncertainty about that. That's truth. That's God's word. That makes it right. So anything that's uncertain is unreliable. And so when days of this time, when they're not certain whether Jesus is the same yesterday and forever, leave the thing alone.
Amen.
You can be certain. Amen. You can know it to be that his... If he never performs any more miracle on you, but the great miracle, forgives your sins.
Amen.
That's the greatest miracle that God ever performed,
yes.
Was to forgive a human being its sin. Take a man and convert him from the things, look, that's changed his innermost being. From the things that he once drank and gambled and done evil and things like that, and all of a sudden turns him right back around to love and goes home to his wife and says, honey, I'm sorry that I treated you like that. Pick up his little children and hold them in the arm. Daddy spent all of his money for whiskey and daddy's done this and mother's been out all night long and left you children. I'll never do it again. God forgive me. And how that testimony, that's one of the greatest things in there. All the Alcoholics Anonymous and all like that can never change like that. They can never do for the person. Look at little old Rosella Griffin. They're sitting there with all the synonymous in Chicago. 4 of the major hospitals, their staff of doctors that gave her out in 1 moment's time on the platform. Change that batty-eyed wretch. Standing there with coat cut like this, a mink coat on, where her mother bought her. She's a smart girl. And carried her whiskey bottles down in that coat there and afraid she'd fall on the street and freeze to death before somebody could find her. There, standing there when all the synonymous and all would give her up. She's writing a book on it now. There she come on the platform. The Holy Spirit said to her, your name is Rosella Griffin. No uncertainty about that. You're an alcoholic. You've been the synonymous and everything. But thus saith the Lord. It's over now. That lady sitting up here on the balcony. She's a Fred Astaire's dancer partner. She jumps up. That's right, she's also an alcoholic and a dope fiend. The law's looking for her now. And her daddy said, "I resent that." She said, "Wait a minute, Daddy. The man's right." No uncertainty about that.
Hallelujah.
Thus saith the Lord, "You're healed. Give yourself up." Now she's out on the field with her husband preaching the gospel.
Hallelujah.
Oh, my. What is it? Jesus Christ the same yesterday, today, forever. In the days when the denomination gives the uncertainty of it, why would we listen to a church denomination when Christ remains the same? No uncertain about that. It's always certain. Now, we know that the Bible says here, if anything that's dead gives a sound, a dead thing, dead churches or what more, can't give sounds, but unless there is a distinction in the sound, unless there's some way that we can be certain. Now, we know here, I got some scriptures wrote down here about soldiers. Yes, soldiers can, in the days of their training, they're trained to those bugles and how them sounds to retreat or to what they're to do and everything. They're trained by sound. And if they didn't know that sound, how would they know to prepare themselves? That's right. But they're trained to that sound. And they know when that sound goes, it means a certain thing. How when Titus besieged the walls of Jerusalem, compassed it about with armies, all those trained soldiers and disciples, how the historians write, Jesus, sitting up on the mount that day, said, "When you see Jerusalem compassed about with armies, let him that's in the field don't return to his house to get his coat. Let him that's in the house go not to the housetop or come down. Said, but flee to the mountains, for there'll be a time of trouble." Now look what all the great denominational churches said when they see Titus marching up. "Now we shall go to the house of the Lord to offer prayer." They were too late.
Amen.
That was an uncertain sound of the priest.
Amen.
That was an uncertain sound of the church.
Amen. Amen.
But to those who had been trained to the voice of Jesus, they took for them out in the voice of God. And the only ones that survived it.
Amen.
The uncertain sound. Flee the city. Now, Jesus, if he hadn't told them that and gave them that training, that sound of training, how would they have known to run? Now, Josephus, the great historian, said the only thing that survived it was them disciples of Christ who were cannibals. One of the historians said they were cannibals. Said they took a man named Jesus of Nazareth that Pilate crucified, and they stole his body out of the grave and went out and cut it up and eat it. What they were doing was taking communion in the body of the Lord, you know, like we do here. See? And said they were the only ones that survived it because they got out of the city.
Amen.
They know the sound. Oh, brother, may the Holy Spirit get in our hearts this morning and give us the sound of that heartbeat of the Holy Ghost and His power. Only that will be able to survive. That sound of the trumpet of God, and our hearts prepared for this hour to know what to do. We which are alive and remain shall not prevent or hinder those which are asleep. For the trumpet shall sound, all those soldiers laying out are asleep across to the ages. But when the trumpet sounds, though they be dead and sleep, it shall not hinder them. For the trumpet shall sound and awaken them. They're prepared.
Amen.
Those unprepared don't know the sound. When that sound of the coming of the Lord blasts, it'll shake heaven and hell when it blasts. But those who are in hell, those who are lost, don't know that sound. They don't know what to do. But those, though they be sleeping in Christ, they know that certain sound. Oh, the trumpet of the Lord shall sound, and time shall be no more. And the morning breaks eternal, bright and fair. When the saved of earth shall gather to their homes beyond the sky. And when that roll is called up yonder, I want to be there. Put your name on the Lamb's Book of Life today. By the blood of the Lord Jesus. And it won't be an uncertain sound. Now, we hear the sounding of trouble coming. Atomic bombs hanging everywhere. Distress between the nations. Perplexed of time. Why would we worry about job? Why would we worry about home? Why would we worry about anything? Jesus never told us to worry, but said, when you see these things begin to come to pass, lift up your head and rejoice, because your redemption's drawing nigh.
Amen.
That's the certainty of the sound of the gospel. And we see the Holy Spirit come into the church, begin to discern the thoughts of the heart, doing these great signs of the return of the Spirit back in the evening time when the lights are shining. We see Him come and do the very same thing He did there at Sodom before it burnt down. See that angel with his back turned, there was Sarah last behind him. Jesus said, as it was in the days of Sodom, so shall it be at the coming of the Son of Man. What is it? It's the sounding forth of the coming of the Lord Jesus. Behold, I'll send you Elijah the prophet before that great and terrible day shall destroy the world. He'll restore the hearts of the children back to the original faith, back to the gospel, back to the power of God, back to the real Holy Spirit, back to Christ again. Before that great day comes, we hear the trumpet sounding. Oh, my. What is it? Awake, ye saints of the Lord, while slumber when the end is nearing. Let's get ready for that final call. If it gives an uncertain sound, who shall prepare themselves for battle? If it's uncertain. But it's not uncertain. People say, what is this stuff they're talking about? The Holy Spirit reading the very minds of the people and the things that He's doing. That's the certainty of the sound of the gospel. Christ said it would be that way. Well, why could all these big churches be? Christ said it would be that way. Not uncertain. It's the certainty of it. We've just been through an 8 days meeting on that. To know that the Bible strictly says that this thing will be that way.
Amen.
Great denominations will rise. They'll all form themselves into a confederation of churches. We got it. Making an image to the beast, the Catholic hierarchy. We make an image unto the beast. There we got it. Confederations. Every denomination in it. It's not an uncertain sound. It gives a real true sound. It's a certain sound. We have got a great faith in our UN, United Nations. Well, it's just about as deep as the League of Nations was.
Amen.
Just the same thing. We had a League of Nations after the First World War. They had to go to police the whole world. It didn't work. The real talk of the UN now, so uncertain they don't know what to do.
Amen.
They're in there when Khrushchev taking off his shoe and beating on the desk. And what good does that do? All the different ones, it's the uncertainty of the UN. The UN's all right as far as it goes, but it's too late.
Amen.
It's too late for anything like that. There's only one certain sound, that's the gospel.
Amen.
Prepare for the battle.
Hallelujah.
What battle? The coming of the Lord.
Amen.
Prepare yourself for battle now against evil.
Amen.
When evil's besetting the people on every hand, everything going wrong, and home life going wrong, and UN falling, and the nations breaking, and atomic bombs around, and homes splitting up, and motherhood going low, and immorals among the people, and distrust amongst one another, and all the denominations fussing and stewing. What you want to do? Be certain.
Amen.
Prepare yourself for the battle.
Amen.
When television is becoming rotten, and radio and newspaper, all the outlets of advertising and things is constantly cigarettes, tobaccos, and whiskey, and drinking, and immoral dressed women, dirty jokes, and jokesters on the television programs, and America falling for it like a big brat, like King Nebuchadnezzar's house of a folly that night, when there come a mad rush through there, and they had a big wine party and dancing on the television, as would have been in that day. Their jokesters got out there, and there come a handwriting on the wall. The day when we thought we were so secure, we had the best scientists in the world. We got the best in the world, come to find out we're way behind in the missile race. And then what's happened to the United States? Not only a handwriting on the wall, but there's a The ballistics of the missiles is riding in the sky.
Amen.
That we're way behind, years behind. What's the matter? The handwriting's on the wall, and in that day, it was wrote in unknown tongues. Handwriting on the wall. There wasn't but one man in the whole kingdom could interpret it. But he had the gift of interpretation. And he interpreted and said, "Thou art weight in the balance and been found wanting." God sent a nation of people in here among you that you call holy rollers. You went down there and disgraced them and put them to death and smothered them out and took your gods and idols and things and just worshiped by it and lived deliciously. And now you went and took the very vessels out of the temple of their God and come over here and cracking jokes on them, making fun of the holy roller, the bald-headed preacher and all like that. And God has got enough of it.
Amen.
The hour of your doom is at hand.
Yes. Amen.
The very nation that would take them is waiting at the gate right there.
Amen.
Just a little after that, they were slaughtered. Their women was cut down. Their guards, their army, everything was taken over. Weighed in the balance and found wanting. And we have been radio and television mad of jokes and dirt and filth and crookedness and honoriness and everything until God's tired of it.
Amen.
When the gospel, the true gospel of the Holy Ghost Church is back and forth across the nation showing the certainty of Jesus Christ and His coming.
Amen.
Until the time is here when God writes across our skies,
Amen,
weighed in the balance and found life.
Amen.
We're in a terrible condition.
Yes.
Listen at the certain sound, not the uncertain. UN, yes, sir. Even the other day when we had election, they said here some time ago that when they counted votes of the political world, and they would say, then they said, I've got a machine now that all has to be honest, because you just pull a little lever and it votes for your man. You pull down a little click and votes for your man. They found out that that's uncertain. Mr. Edgar Hoover exposed the Democrat Party the other day. When they had the machine set up, and every time they voted for Mr. Nixon, they had to vote for Kennedy the same. And why don't they do something about it then if they find out it's like that? Why? Well, there's no certainty to it. You know what happened, Mr. Hoover? You see, everything's uncertain. You can't tell who was elected, whether Kennedy or whether Kennedy was called elected. But I don't know whether he's elected or not. Now, I'm not a politician. I know nothing about it, but I know what's right and wrong. I got that much sense. Before us, that the man is proved by the FBI that they had the machine set up to do it. It wasn't on the other party done that way. It was on the Kennedy's party that did it. Why? It has to be that way. There's nothing in this world that can stand outside the kingdom of God.
Amen.
For every kingdom is weighed in a balance and found wanting. Our nation, why is it? Here some years ago, I used to have a big old tree up here I used to go to and sit down. And I thought, that tree, when I'm an old man, if I live, I'll come sit on that tree. It's just a snag now. The place where I used to live, I'd see my daddy come out there in his little short arms. He was Kentuckian down there, and he logged and things. A little fellow about 145 or 50 pounds. But stout, oh my, Mr. Coots up here told me he'd see him load a 950-pound ash log by himself. Just a real strong man. I used to see him roll up his sleeves to wash out there, but an old piece of broken glass stuck on the apple tree. Some of you Indiana people might not know how we used to have to live. Went back in there, an old wash pan sitting out there with a pitcher pump, and Mom had an old sack, their meal sack, made a towel out of it, kind of decorated up, pulled some of the strings out, make little decorations at the end. Big old, she'd scrub me and then rub me that towel of hide, it almost come off. With that old rough meal sack, she'd scrubbing me and rubbing me with that old towel. Now, I'd see Dad stand there, come in, you know, roll up on the little sleeves, and he'd be washing, oh my, see them bunsels. I said, you know, he'll live to be 500 years old. He's so strong. But you know what? He died when he was 52. Why? Here we have no continuing city. I stood yonder in Rome, where the great Caesar stood, that walked through the streets with their great mast and the pomp and the glory and all they had. And you know where to find their kingdom? It's 20 feet under the ground.
Amen.
2,000 years of sunken. I stood in Cairo, Egypt, where the great Pharaoh stood in one day that persecuted the people of God, that run them out and made slaves out of them. 20 or 30 feet below there is the ruins of their place. I stood down in London, England, where all the great hierarchies and things that stood and all that, and find out it's sunk beneath the ground. What is it? Here we have no continuing city, but we're seeking one to come. Why are these kingdoms? It's only to tell you, speaking of one that's eternal.
Amen.
Why is a tree beautiful? It's waiting. It's waiting for the full manifestations of the sons of God when that tree shall live forever. There's a kingdom that'll come in there. The Bible said, here we have no continuing city, but we seek one to come. And there, God has given us a kingdom that cannot be moved. Everything on earth is movable, is shakable, is falling. Everything is decaying. We're living in a dying world. Everything's dying. Trees are dying. Grass is dying. Flowers are dying. Cities are dying. The world's are dying. You're dying. Everything's dying. I'm dying. Everything's dying. The certain rays of acids and stuff in the air, chemicals in the air. Just even you take this big bridge down here. When I saw it come 22 years before it was put up down there, I saw the man lose their lives on it. When they put the bridge across there and spoke up, my mother won't take me to the doctor, thought I was having nervous spasms. And I told her, I said, I've seen a bridge go across, and I counted that man. 22 years after that, the bridge went across, and the same amount of men lost their lives. I think it was 16. Exactly. Now I thought when they put those big girders up there, that bridge will last forever. Oh, they painted it 3 or 4 times, and it's rusting down right now. What is it? The rays in the air burn it up. We find a beautiful young girl of 16 sitting in a church popping chewing gum and cutting up and carrying on, going outside and pulling her clothes to a little place where she looks sexy to twist herself down. It isn't a few settings of the sun and she's old and wrinkled and the flesh dropping off of her. That little body that she twisted and let a spirit live in there, controlled her, throwed her morals to the dogs and have to answer the day of judgment for committing adultery. Whosoever looketh upon a woman to lust after her has committed adultery with her already, not realizing that she's nothing but dust and going back to the dust, for dust thou art, dust thou shalt return. What is it? If she could only realize and stop, that's an uncertain sound. Well, so-and-so on the television, so-and-so at school, trying to impersonate certain little personalities at school. Don't you never let that be your pattern.
Amen.
Look to God.
Amen.
Oh, uncertain sounds, elections. How that the time has come. Now, uncertainty. If we had time, let's just turn to it. I'm seeing the sisters all putting them scriptures down. Now, in 2 Timothy 2, let's read just for a few minutes. 2 Timothy, the second chapter, and beginning with the 2 Timothy, the third chapter, let's just read. Listen here. Know this also, now this is the Spirit. Know this also that in the last days perilous times shall come. Now that's the Holy Spirit that you hear in the church this morning, speaking way back under 2,000 years ago, AD 66 to this day. For men shall be lovers of their own selves, boasters, proud, blasphemers, disobedient to parents, unthankful, unholy. Look at that day today. You speak of holy, they call you holy roller.
Amen.
Look at children, how they do. Juvenile delinquency. They talk of it. Now, I'm going to differ with you, parents. It isn't juvenile delinquency, it's parent delinquency.
Amen.
That's what it is.
Amen.
Somebody call these old Kentucky mothers up here how illiterate Kentucky was. Them old mammies up there with a old song bunnet on like that and talk about her being so illiterate and don't know her ABCs. She might not be so classy, but I tell you, let one of her daughters come in like some of yours some night.
Yeah.
Toes twisted off of her and lipstick all over her face and her hair all mangled up. She won't say, did you have a great time, darling? She'd grab a flat off of something and she'd know the last time she went out. Then you called her literacy. Yeah, that's it. unthankful, unholy, without natural affections, truce breakers, false accusers, incontinent, fierce, and despisers of those that are good, hates the people who try to live right. See? Traitors, heady, high-minded, lovers of pleasure more than lovers of God. My, they'll spend millions of dollars to go to a ball game or something like that, or where some movie stars go to do a certain something or other like that. It's like the old Roman circus many years ago. But when it comes to going across the street to a Holy Ghost meeting, you sit and laugh on their porch at it. Well, you say, well, Brother Branham, that's communist. All right, let's see what the fifth verse says. Having a form of godliness, but denying the power thereof. Denying the power of what? The power of God.
Amen.
Having a form of God, but denying the power of God.
Amen.
Going to church and belonging to a denomination, but denying the very existence of the Holy Ghost that's in the church, making it act and do with the very same things it did at the beginning.
Amen.
Oh, my. See how that denominational curse is? I hope you don't get angry with me. But I hope you get it in the light that I'm trying to say it in. Hey? Now, notice this. Having a form of godliness, but denying the power thereof, from such, what you saying to the church? Turn away. Turn away from it. Come out of it. Right. For, listen, let's read another verse or two. Just listen. For, let's see how certain them kind of people are. See if it's uncertain. For of this sort are they which creep into homes and lead captive silly women, laden with sin, turning away with divers lusts, ever learning and never able to come to the knowledge of the truth.
Yes. Amen.
What is truth? Jesus Christ is truth.
Amen.
He said, I am the truth. Pilate said, what is truth? I am the way, the truth, the life.
Amen.
Women with all kind of ladies' societies and making blankets and going together and telling jokes and having suppers and soup suppers to pay the pastor and so forth like that, and never able to come to the knowledge of knowing Jesus Christ exists today in the power of his resurrection in the Holy Ghost. Never silly women. I wasn't talking to you sisters. I said silly women. All right. Laden with divers' love. You know better than that. So I'm glad for you, my sister. Never able. How uncertain that sound, man, a formal denomination is. How uncertain is the sound of the church today. Who knows what to do? Let me show you. The church today, there's a war cloud hanging everywhere. Troubles everywhere. People run into their church and can't find the answer.
Amen.
I'm going to preach on that Christmas night. No answer for the star in the east. Now, notice, oh my, they're hanged and they haven't got the answer. They don't know what to say. Why? The only thing they can refer back, we learned this in college. The church isn't depend on what they did in college, but it's the living Holy Spirit in the church.
Amen.
Leading it and guiding it and foreshowing it things to come like it did in the days of Titus.
Amen.
Warning them of things to come to flee the wrath that is to come. Oh my, he that has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit says unto the churches. Now, is there anything then, I don't want to keep you too long this morning, but is there anything that is certain? If I've told you so many things that is uncertain, is there anything that is certain? Is there any certainty about anything at all? Why, certainly. I'm so thankful that there is.
Amen, amen.
Is there anything that is certain? I'll tell you what is certain. That's the gospel of Jesus Christ.
Amen.
Now, if you want to put it down, we won't turn to it, but you can if you want to. Matthew 24:35. Jesus speaking of these days and what was coming to pass. Matthew 24:35. He said, heavens and earth will pass away, but my word shall never pass away.
Amen.
That's certain, isn't it?
Amen.
That's one thing as certain as his word.
Amen.
Now, there's one thing. We see we can't build up on our church. We can't build up on our nation. It's too uncertain. But there's one thing it's certain, that's God's word is certain.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
You're certain you're going to have to do it. One of them said one certain thing was the taxes. Oh, no. Taxes ain't too certain. The Lord may come.
Amen.
They can charge it off, man. It's all over there. They said death is certain. No, sir, death isn't certain.
Amen.
No, indeed. There might be a rapture.
Amen.
Then there's no death. Death ain't too certain. No, no. Not in this day. It was many years ago, but not now. Death is not too certain. And anyhow, I know a man one time that walked with God for an example to show, and one day he got tired walking, so he just got real light and started walking up and went on up home with God. Anybody know who he was?
Amen.
Enoch. And what was he? A type of the church in this day. And Noah, which is a type that we had that last week in our lesson, Noah, the type of Israel that's carried over, will be over there on Mount Transfiguration, over there in Europe, down in Palestine, watching, and when Noah saw Enoch was missing, he thought, what become of Enoch? What become of Enoch? Where's he at? Which was grandson. Noah was grandson to Enoch. And he said, where's it at? What become of him? We can't find him no more. Noah started building on that ark. He knew that the time was at hand right then.
Amen.
And now when the church is taken up and people say, well, I've called the police. I put out calls. She was sitting right at the table and she vanished. I just don't know what become of her. Well, it's not only that. Well, police say we've got 500 calls of that this morning. What happened? It's over then for you Gentiles. That's right. Watching. The word of God is certain. Heavens and earth will pass away, Matthew 24:35. But God's promises cannot fail.
Amen.
Jesus said all heavens and earth will pass away. You say heavens? Yep. Revelation 21, John said, I saw a new heaven and a new earth.
Amen.
For the first heaven and first earth was passed away. And there were no more seeing. I, John, saw the holy city, the new Jerusalem, descending out of heaven as a bride. That's what it was. Adorned for her husband. Oh, that's where I want to be. God help me to be there that day.
Amen.
All right. God's promises is certain. We realize that. Now, let's just take a little scripture or a little trip and go back and find out something who believed in days gone by. How they come out by trusting whether God's word was a certain sound. Now let's go back to the beginning of the Bible just for two or three characters and we'll be ready for the prayer line in the next 15 minutes or something. Now let's go back to the first and take Brother Noah in the beginning. Noah in Genesis. We find out that there was two or three sounds, many sounds being given out in the days of Noah. One of them, Noah heard the voice of God said it's going to rain. Now, God, listen, God usually tells you something that's so absolutely foolish to the things of the world.
Amen.
That it just, he does it to confound the world.
Amen.
They're just confounding their mind. They say, now, a bunch of holy rollers, oh, goodness sakes, don't tell me that. That God, the holy God, will live such a bunch as that. That's the same thing that Balak said and Balaam said. When we look down and see Israel, said, well, they've done everything mean there was on the line to do, but he failed to see that smitten rock and that brass serpent.
Amen.
And see them signs and wonders of healing and things in the camp.
Amen.
Fundamentally, they were just the same. But God does something so radical. God is radical.
Amen.
Now that sounds strange, but he is. Now we just find out with a few characters. Look at Noah. Now the Bible says that in Noah's day, it had never rained from heaven. God watered the earth up through the earth. It never rained. And here is a fanatic out yonder building a big old boat about two city blocks long. A boat to float when there wasn't nothing for it to float in.
Amen.
There was no water. There wasn't even any only thing on earth. The biggest thing was a spring. Now, what's he building that thing for and pitching it within and without and things like that? Why, they say, where's that water coming from, Noah? From up there. Well, I'm a scientist, and I can prove with this air that there ain't no water up there. It would have come right down now. There's none up there. I can scientifically prove you that there's none up there. Well, but Noah said, you know, God's able to put some up there.
Glory.
That's it. God said it would be up there, and it'll be up there. Well, what are you doing, Noah? I'm getting ready for it.
Amen.
I'm making ready. Well, now, science was given a sound. Science said that bunch of holy rollers rolling on that hill is actually crazy. Well, they're beside themselves.
Amen. That's right.
Well, you're hewing out a big old bolt there. Well, what in the world are they going to do with it? Well, if we took every spring in the world and put it all in water, it wouldn't be enough to even dampen the hull. And here they say it's going to float,
hallelujah,
and that water is coming down from up there.
Hallelujah.
But Noah, no matter how foolish science said it was, he was listening to a certain sound.
Amen.
God said, I'm going to destroy the world with water. Nothing uncertain about that.
Amen.
It sounded uncertain then, but it was God's word.
Amen.
No matter how silly it sounds, God said, I'm the Lord that healeth thee. There's nothing uncertain about that.
Amen.
You believe that? God said, I'll give whosoever will the Holy Ghost that comes. There's nothing uncertain about that.
Right.
Say, I'm a drunkard, I'm a prostitute, I don't care what you are. Whosoever will, let him come. Nothing
Amen.
Uncertain. I'd rather you'd said that and said, if William Branham will come in 1960, I'll give him the fountains of water of life. Now, that would have been pretty good. Looked like it was me, but there might be two William Branhams. But I wouldn't know which one was me. But when he said, whosoever, I know that was me anyhow. For I was one that wanted to come. See? So, you see, God's word is certain. Now, to the outside world, the scientific world, it sounds very uncertain. See, because that, now who would ever think? Now look, there's the moon at night. There's the stars. There's the atmospheres. And they were way smarter in that day, you know, than they are now. They built the Sphinx in that day. Could we build it today? One paw, it would take 16 flat cars to put it on there and sets a half a city block high in the air. Could we build it? They built the pyramid in that day. One of those boulders in there weighs hundreds of thousands of tons. Well, we ain't got nothing in the world could build it. We ain't got no power, that gasoline or anything else never lifted up there. You couldn't have a machine big enough. And it's so perfectly, so there's no mortar in it. But they cut it here on the ground and got it up there somehow. And you can't take a razor blade and slice along in it like that, fitting so close together. Smarter than we are now. And that same smart, they had a die back there. They could make a mummy in that day. We can't make one today. We couldn't make a human body a mummy. We don't know what to put in them to make them look natural. They had dye. They put in cloth in that day that we don't have it now. We couldn't do nothing like it. There's just many things they had then that we didn't have. Here some time ago, they dug up a modern waterworks right here in Mexico that had been sunk during the Antediluvian. Modern waterworks. Way smarter than we are today. See, as it was in the days of Noah, smart people like this, so will it be in the coming of the Son.
Amen.
Another smart generation. How smart those people were. Probably greater science that can measure how far each star was apart. They were so smart to geographically, they put that big big pyramid right in so center in the earth to no matter where the sun is, there's never a shadow around it. Morning, evening, midday, anywhere, no shadow around it. See? I've been there. Now notice, all these things that they did and the powers that they had, and could you imagine it never rained and nothing in the skies to make it rain? How in the world did that man ever get that message over? He didn't. That was it.
Amen.
But as Noah stood in the door of the ark and warned the people of the oncoming destructions, so is a gospel preacher that's born again today,
Amen.
Standing in the door, Christ
Amen.
Jesus,
Amen.
Is shrouded around by the Holy Ghost, warning the people of a coming destruction.
Amen. Amen.
As it was in the days of Noah. Here we are, standing in this day. Now, how could science say rain come from there? But you see, God knows how to bring rain from there. He either caused an earthquake, or somebody had atomic power that they throwed it and bursted some part of the earth, and it swung the earth backward, throwed it out of its orbit, and now it leans back. And when they did that, the heat of the earth and the cold of the earth from the sun and away from the sun caused a cloud to come over. He's Jehovah Jireh. He can provide himself
Amen.
Anything
Amen.
That his
Amen.
Word says. Now, he can provide himself a church.
Amen.
He don't have to have me. He don't have to have you.
Amen.
No, he don't. He doesn't have to have. He can provide. Somebody else can take your place.
Right.
Be careful some don't take your crown. He don't have to have us. But we have to have him.
Amen.
If you ever live, you've got to have him, because he's the only one, as Peter said, when he said, "Will you all go so?" When he got to telling the truth, he was a great man when he's healing all their sick. Oh, when he had signs and wonders following him, he was a great man. But when he began to tell them the truth, then what happened? Then he became a fanatic.
Yeah.
Walked away from him. He turned around to the disciples. Remember, he was very independent because he was God. He turned around and said, "You want to go too?" Peter said, "Lord, who would we go to?
Amen.
Where would we go? For you're the one that has the words of eternal life." And we are sure of this. There's no uncertainty about that. We are sure that you're the one that has it. We are not tossed about with every wind of doctrine. We know that you've got the words of eternal life, because no man can do the things you do unless God be in him. Nicodemus said the same remark. Now, let's see. Then Noah, was the sound uncertain Noah was listening to? Oh, sure, it was right. We had an antediluvian destruction, destroyed all the world, and God sent the water just the way he said. Why? Because the word of God said so. Science drowned and perished. Look, the very thing that saved Noah killed his critics.
Amen.
Did you know that?
Amen.
The very water, if there hadn't been no water, Noah couldn't have been saved. The ark was the one that floated. So the very thing that floated the ark drowned the critic. And the very Holy Spirit today that people are making fun of, it will save the church and condemn the critic.
Amen.
The very same thing. The very same thing. What saves kills the out. What saves the believer condemns the unbeliever. That's right. So you see, have faith in God's word. That's one thing you can stand on and know it's certain.
Amen.
What God says, it's certain. Just believe it. Now, let's take another fellow in the days of Moses. Now, Moses had tried through educational programs. He had tried through military programs to deliver Israel, because he knew he was born to do it, and it was the hour for him to do it. But he tried his own way, his education, and forming his big society or something other, making a military proposition out of it. With his own ethics, he failed. Now, listen close. But one day, God got a hold of him by a burning bush. And look how unreasonable God did that man. Now, God pulled him up to the burning bush and he talked to him. Now, God never talked to him before. He just learned it out of a book. So God talked to him. That's the reason Noah knows what he's talking about. God talked to him. That's how he knew it. He heard it from God, see. And now, one day when Moses trained, polished, oh my, was he a scholar. My, and was he a military man? And he thought, with all of my scholarship, I've got a PhD, a DDD, a double LD, and all the DDs that can be thought of. But now, surely I know how to do this, because I'm the brains of Egypt. I don't care what you're the brains of.
Yeah.
It's no good. When it comes to God, it's foolishness. Your brains is foolishness to God.
Yeah.
Because my ways are higher than your ways, and my thoughts are higher than your thoughts, says God. See? So your best brains, like Paul said, I don't come to you preaching to you words with enchanting words like the wisdom does. Because if I did that, your hopes would be built. Now, Paul could do that because he was a smart man. He said, I could do that, but what was it? You'd rest upon the philosophy of man. But I come to you in the power and the resurrection with the Holy Ghost, that your faith would be in God. There you are. Because that's an uncertain sound, the other one is, but this is certain. True. Well then, Moses had tried by an uncertain sound his ethics, his education. It was uncertain. But one day he heard a certain sound.
Amen.
Oh.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Now I feel religious. Yes, he heard a certain sound. For he saw a light hanging in a bush.
Amen.
Amen.
Take off your shoes.
Amen.
Where you're standing calls this holy ground. He said, I heard the cries of my people and I remember my word. Amen. Nothing uncertain about that. I remember what I told Isaac and Jacob and Abraham and all of them. I remember my promises. I don't forget them. I see the cries of them people and the time is at hand. I'm going to send you, Moses. Moses said, how can I ever go back? Listen. Certainly, I will be with you.
Amen.
Nothing uncertain about that.
Amen.
Thy is Moses' soul, I'll be with thee. And I will be with you. There's nothing uncertain about it.
Amen.
I'll be with you. He told Joshua years later, as I was with Moses, so will I be with you. How am I going to take those great walled cities? That's not for you to figure out. I was with Moses, I'll be with you, and everywhere your foot treads is possession. Just keep walking. Nothing's going to stand before you all the days of your life. Nothing uncertain about that. I'll be with you.
Amen.
Surely I will be with you, said God to Moses. Now I want you to notice when a man hears the voice of God, personally hears the word of God. Now you can hear it. You say, well, God has come to meet me. Yes, sir. I could sit here and preach till I fell dead in the pulpit 10, 20, 30, 50 years from now. You'd never hear it until God reveals the word to you.
Amen.
You can sit right in your seat. You don't have to be by a burning bush. Maybe you're closer than you think you are. Just sit there and let God speak to you in the Word. I got to quit this kind of life I'm living. I got to be right. That's God. God in His Word.
Amen.
Making Himself known to you. I ought to make my life right with God. That's God. That's God is certain. I've got to die someday. Certainly you're going to die. I've got to answer the judgment. Certainly you're going to answer the judgment. Then where is your judgment? Yonder at the throne where you have no mercy, or here at the throne where you can get mercy?
Amen.
Now, if you're the choice, that's a tree like in the Garden of Eden, one of life and one of death. Put it all for there, you die. Take it now and you live. Now, you're the judge. See, you're the one that has to... You're the judge now, but He's the judge then. You're judge now, whether you want it or not. He's the judge then, whether you received it or not.
Amen.
So you just have to make up your mind what you want to do. But it's up to you. Every man, like Adam and Eve, the right and wrong set before every person. And you have to make your mind. Surely I'll be with you. How would I ever go back and tell my boss that I got saved and filled with the Holy Ghost? Surely I'll be with you.
Amen.
How will I ever tell my husband that I'm going to quit my meanness? How will I ever be able to do that? Surely I'll be with you. How can I tell my wife that I've lived wrong. I've done things wrong. How can I ever do this? How can I ever stand before my family again? How will they ever believe me when they know that I've cursed and carried on and done the things I've done and go back and tell them I'm a Christian? Surely, I'll be with you, said God. It'll make you do things you wouldn't think. Look at Moses, how radical it made him. What did he do? That man, 80 years old. You say, well, Brother Branham, I'm getting to be a middle-aged man, an old man, or I don't care how old you are. That don't have one thing to do. The day that God can get you quiet enough to speak to you and you hear His Word, that's the day He's talking to you. No matter your age. How can I ever do it, Brother Branham? Look at Moses. 80 years old. Egypt had the whole world conquered. They held all the military secrets and everything in their own hands. And Moses put his wife a straddle of a little old mule, put Gershom on her hip, and here he goes the next morning with a crooked stick in his hand. The white whiskers hanging down like this and probably his bald head shining like that. And this old mule going down through there, pulling this old mule along, just hollering, glory to God. Praise the Lord. Somebody say, Moses, where are you going? Going down to Egypt to take the thing over. How ridiculous. But when a man talks to God and has got the voice of God in him and the Word of God in him, if ye abide in me, John 15, if you abide me and my words in you, you can ask what you will, and it'll be done to you.
Amen.
See? Nothing uncertain, it shall be done. That's right. Nothing uncertain. Moses, Moses might have said to God, how am I going to do that? It'll be a one-man invasion. How can me, an old man, you're 80 years old, and how am I going to go down there to that great big army of millions of men and take it over? Surely I'll be with you. That's all he had to know.
Amen.
There he goes. Here he goes. He's going down, and he took over, too.
Amen.
Why? He was certain that the sound that he heard was right. And the sound that you hear this morning is right because it's the Word of God. The Hebrew children at the fiery furnace, how did they know they'd be delivered? They said, our God's able to deliver us. He had never done it before. He's able to deliver us in this fiery furnace. But nevertheless, we are certain that He's able. No uncertainty about that.
Amen.
We just know His will, but however, we're not bowing to your image. We're not going out on that party. We're not going to smoke cigarettes. We're not going to drink that liquor. We're not going to tell them lies. We're not going to commit adultery. We're not going to run out on our wives anymore, or husbands anymore. we are certain God can deliver us.
Amen.
Well, if you do, they'll throw you out of the bunco game. They'll throw you out of the card party, ladies' aid. I don't care what they do to me. God's able to deliver us.
Amen. Hallelujah.
You know what they're going to do? They'll call you old-fashioned, let your hair grow out again. If you do that, then wear them long clothes and act like a lady. You know what they're going to do? They'll call you old-fashioned. I don't care what they do, but God is able to deliver me. And that's the thing I'm asking today. God is able to deliver me. That's all. Well, if you don't wear shorts this next summer, what's Susie going to say? I don't care what Susie says. I want to know what God says.
Amen.
Because Susie has an uncertain sound, but God's is right.
Amen.
That's a certain sound. So he did deliver him. How certain was Abraham after waiting 25 years for a baby that God told him that he'd had? Could you imagine Abraham? An old man, good reputation amongst the people. And one day God spoke to him and said, Abraham, I'm going to make you a father of nations. Go change your name. Now I call you Abraham. From Abram to Abraham. And I'm going to call her from Sarah, S-A-R-R-A, to S-A-R-R-A-H, princess. I'm going to change her name. And now you're both, let's see, Abraham, you're 75 and she's 65. You've been living with her since she was about 16, 17 years old, because she's your half-sister. And you've been living with her all this time. You married her when she's just a little girl. And yet you've had no children, but I'm going to do it. I'm going to give you a baby. And do you believe me, Abraham? Yeah, Lord, I believe you. Now, they're going to say you're crazy. Oh, that's all right, Lord. It's okay. You told me you're going to have a baby? Well, he goes around, grabs Sarah, said, honey, you know what? We're going to have a baby. What? A baby? Yeah. How do you know? God said so. Amen. That's right. Then, honey, we'll go have it. Well, now, you know what I'm going to do? You give me a little money. I'm going down to buy some booties and go get some bird eye and some pins. And we're going to get ready for this baby. See, because it's coming right now. Yes, sir. So down the store she went. And I heard him go down to the doctor and say, doctor, you know what? Won't you make ready over to the hospital? We're going to have a baby. what'd you say your name was? Abraham. Yeah, yes, sir. Excuse me, I'm in a hurry today. See, go back. Say, hey, you better send the authorities out to test that old man's mind. Well, he's 75 years old, and that old woman sat around there with a little shawl over her shoulder like a little grandma and says, you go to have a baby? Well, ain't that the son of her down there that come down from up in Shinehart up there at the tower? Isn't that his son? Yeah. Well, the poor old fella, he got out in too much sun. His sunstroke, he's a little crazy, see? Yeah. But that's an uncertain sound. But Abraham had a certain sound. Well, authority says he's been a loyal old man. I know a lot of times he give the widows things, and he give things. They, she's awful kind. I don't want to lock them up or anything. Don't put them out there against the tree in them shackles and things like that. They'd be worse. I tell you, we just keep an eye on them. You know, and they kept watching. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. What an uncertain sound. But Abraham knew that sound was certain. So he said, first month passed. How you feeling, honey? Any different? Now, remember, you ladies, the 28th day, she'd passed it long ago, about 40 years old. Near she was 65. How you feeling, honey? Well, dear, there's no difference. Glory to God, we're going to have it anyhow. Nothing uncertain. Certain, I'm positive. Yes, sir, I'm sure we're going to have it. How you know Abraham's going to have it? God said so. Going to have it anyhow. Well, second month, third month, first year. Feel any different, honey? No, nothing's happened yet. No, no. Well, glory to God, we're going to have it anyhow. Abraham, I heard that you said you was going to have a baby. That's an uncertain sound, see? But Abraham had done heard another sound that drowned all that out. Glory to God! I don't care how long we waited. Go to have it anyhow. How do you know, Abraham? God said so. Now, did God come down and talk to you? Yes. How do you know? Let me hear him. He talked to me, not to you.
Amen.
Go on. Say, go on, you unbeliever. You don't believe anyhow. I believe. That's it. Go to have a baby anyhow. 25 years passed. But before that time comes, this Teehee and Lavin, God said, you know what? I'm just going to take you away from them. Pack up all your clothes and things. Get around.
Amen.
Get out, separate yourself from that bunch of unbelievers.
Amen.
I'm going to give you a little church over here, some people will believe you. Get away from my old cold formal denominations. Get out here. Walk with me alone.
Amen.
God never blessed him until he completely did that.
Yeah.
Separate himself from all the unbelief. And he'll never bless you till you do the same.
Amen.
Take all them old superstitions away from you, and maybe it's so and maybe it's not. If you're come to be prayed for this morning, you come with a real faith. God
Amen.
Said so, and that settles
Amen.
It. That's it. God said so.
Amen.
That's all there is to it. God said so, he said it, and that settled it. You don't have any more fuss about it. Think about it. All right. Now, after 25 years, and Abraham had become an old man now. He was 100 years old. And Sarah was 90 years old. Now think of that. Little grandma, little shawl across her shoulder, little dust cap, and grandpa, you know, like this. And I feel, honey. No different. We'll have it anyhow. Glory to God. One day he happened to look, and here come three men walking up. They sat down. Two of them went down to Sodom to preach. He said, Abraham, where's your wife, Sarah? Oh, my. I remember Jesus said that take place again, you know, that same angel. He recognized they were angels. See, he had heard that sound. When he heard that man speak, there was something about that that he recognized that was the same voice. See, he knew that was the same one. He said, Sarah, slipped in, said, honey, slip out there real quick and dust off the hearth real quick and roll out some, knead some, take a wedge and put it in the old sifter. You remember them? Sift out some meal. How many of you Kentuckians remember that one? My, you ought to. I see Mom take that old thing and beat, bang, 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 and rub it, and bang, 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 shaking that meal out to make us some whole cakes. And, man, boil out them old meat skins in the frying pan, you know, or bread pan, and put the grease in it, and black-eyed peas and turnip greens. Pretty good eating. So then, when the cider got hard and made vinegar, you know, and took all the mold off the top of it, put a little vinegar on it. It's good. So then I see Sarah baking these whole cakes out on this right night. Abraham went out and felt to see where he'd get a little fat calf and killed it and brought it and fixed it. Went out there and said, there's something about that man. I've heard that voice before. I know he's got dust all over his clothes and things. He's sitting there rubbing his face and looking around like that. But I'm telling you, I know that voice. Because it ain't an uncertain sound, because I heard it 25 years ago, and honey, we've been trusted all this time. There's something about that man. I don't know why, but there's something about him I believe. All right. So when he got out, and he got the fly bush and shoot all the flies away, you know, and sit there while they eat. So then after a while, two of them again looked down towards Sodom, and they went on down there. A modern preacher went down there to preach the gospel then. So Abraham was sitting there with this man, and he had his back turned to the tent. He said, Abraham, where's your wife, Sarah? Said, she's in the tent behind you. Said, according to the time of life, I'm going to visit you according to the promise that I made to you. You know that sound was certain there.
Amen.
What happened? Immediately after the angel left, Sarah become a young woman.
Amen.
Beautiful. Shook right back, showing to what he's going to do to every seed of Abraham.
Amen.
That old grandma become a young woman, and Abraham, the hump went out of his back, and the white beard went away. He was a young man again. And they took a little trip 300 miles down to Gerar. And when they got down there, Amalek, the king of the Philistines down there, was looking for a wife. And he looked all around them pretty Philistine women, which they are beautiful. And so he looked around there, seeing all them Philistine women, and said, I just can't pick one somehow. Another. Just one day he seen little Sarah coming down, now 100 years old, little grandma. He said, that's the one I'm waiting for. There she is. That's her. So he took her and was going to marry her, and God appeared to him in a dream and said, you take her?
Yes.
Said, that's my prophet's wife. Said, you're as good as a dead man. He said, Lord, you know the integrity. No uncertainty about that. He said, you take him back. I won't hear any prayer that you say to me. I won't hear nothing about it because he's a prophet. And you take her back and restore, because he needs a little money. That's reason all this happened. So he needs some money, so you go out there and restore his wife back to him. If you don't, you're as good as a dead man. But nothing uncertain about that, because God closed up every womb of everything he had. Said, exactly right. He went out there and said, Abraham, why'd you do this? He said, well, she is my sister, as I told you she was. But said, she become my wife. And then went on. What was it? Then when that little baby was born, after all these years, when they turned back again, God said one day, he said, take him up on a mountain, cut his throat. Oh, my. Genesis 22, he tucked this little baby up there, and tucked little Isaac, or when the baby is about 14 years old, put his little curls back like that, and tucked out the knife, that old trembling hand of that old father, no doubt, swallowing hard, choking back, you know, my only son, I've waited all these years. My, I never had a boy. Look at him, here he's my only son. Poor little fellow, but God, you told me to do it. I know to trust your word. I don't know how you're going to do it, but Lord, you gave him to me as one from the dead. Now, if you want to put that down, Hebrews 11, 17 to 19. Let us just turn to it, and then we'll just get it. Hebrews 11, 7 to 19. We're fixing to close just in a minute. 11, 17 All right. By faith Abraham, when he was tried, offered up Isaac. And he that received the promise, offered up his only begotten son, of whom it was said that in Isaac shall thy seed be called. Accounting, the 19th verse, accounting that God was able to raise him up even from the dead, from whence also he received him in figure. Abraham said, Lord, if you get back yonder when I was barren, I had nothing, I was a sinner, and you made me something. You made me a promise. And here it is, you give me this boy, and I waited 25 years for him to come. And now 14 years later, well, here he is, a young man, just the pride of his mother's heart. I slipped him out in the house, keep mother wouldn't understand it. But I understand you, Lord. I know that your voice is true. Now, you told me to offer him up to kill him. And you told me that through me, I'd be the father of many nations. Through this boy, that you'd take this boy, and through him, when you made me the promise and cut those pieces of meat apart that day, and that little white light went between them, you made me a promise that according to this child here, that you'd rise up your own son. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
You'd bring your own son. Through the seed of my son, you'd bring your son, and he'd save all nations. I don't know how you're going to do it, Lord. It's not my business, but I know the certainty of that. I know the certainty of your promise. And I'm persuaded that I received him as one from the dead. And I'm fully persuaded that you're able to raise him up from the dead. If I said, you can raise him back again. I'll take your word, Lord. Pulled out the knife, said, bye, Isaac. Kissed him, pulled back, and God said, wait a minute, Abraham. Wait a minute. I know you believe me. I know you love me. Stay your hand. About that time, you heard something behind him. Look, and there was a ram hooked in the bushes. Where'd that ram come from? Where did he come from? He was 100 miles from civilization, back in the wilderness where there's lions, wolves, jackals, and all those things like that. It killed sheep, and then he was way up on top of the mountain where there's no water or nothing else up there for the sheep to live on. And it wasn't there a minute before that. Look back, and there it was the next minute there.
Amen.
Jehovah Jireh, God said.
Amen.
Abraham looked up and said, you are Jehovah Jireh.
Amen.
What does Jehovah Jireh mean? You can provide anything that you say.
Amen.
If you said so, that does it. You're able to
Amen.
Make it. He, what did he do? He had to hear the same sound that Noah heard. When, how's he going to get the water up there in the skies? I don't know, but he's Jehovah Jireh.
Amen.
He can provide
Amen.
Water up there.
Amen.
How's he going to lift up a man from this earth and take him into glory? I can't tell you. We're heavy. I weigh 150 pounds. I weigh 200. I don't care what you weigh. He's Jehovah Jireh.
Amen.
How's the transportation coming? I can't tell you, but he'll have transportation.
Amen.
That's when it comes.
Amen.
Say this on behalf of my colored friend sitting here this morning. Down south, there was an old colored man packing a Bible around. He said, and his boss making fun of him because he said he had heartfelt religion. He said, there is no such thing as heartfelt religion. He said, boss, there's one thing you lack. He said, ain't no such thing as heartfelt religion as far as you know. See, but he know different. He said, why are you doing that Bible? You can't read. He said, I believe it. He said, I believe it from kiver to kiver and believe the kiver also. Because, he said, because he's got a holy Bible wrote on it. He said, I guess you believe all them stories there? I said, yes, sir. But I believe everything that God said. Everything God tells me, I believe. He said, now listen, Sambo, you can't do that. He said, now what if God tell you jump through that stone wall there? Would you do it? He said, yes, sir. I jump right through that stone wall. He said, how are you going to get through that stone wall with no hole in it? He said, if God told me to jump, he'd have a hole when I got there.
Amen.
So that's just not right. That's right.
God
Amen. Will keep his word.
Amen. Hallelujah.
No uncertainty Amen. About that. When the trumpet of God sounds in your ears, the gospel trumpet, that's certain.
Amen.
Amen. Stay right with it. Oh, it's certain. Why all these people now, and we're getting past time, just one more comment or two scriptures here I got wrote down. I think, why do all these people do this? Because they had heard the voice of God. Now, real quickly, now to finish up in about 3 or 4 minutes. Jesus, when he was on earth, he said, I have power to lay my life down. I have power to take it up again.
Amen.
Now, there wasn't nothing uncertain about that. I have. Not I will have, but I have now. I have power to lay my life down. I have power to take it up again. All right. Martha, after she had lost her brother Lazarus, she heard him say, I will go and wake him up. Said, where have you buried him? Now, she'd sent and said, Jesus, come heal my brother. He's sick. Jesus never paid attention and went on. She sent again. her and Mary. And they went on. You never paid any attention to it. Then, after a while, Lazarus died. Put him in the grave. He's stinking. Laid him there for 4 days. Nose done dropped in. Maggots in him. Everything wrapped up in these clothes and things. Laying rock over top of the grave. Just to bury the dead in the orange. They just have a hole and lay a rock over top of it. And that was the grave. So they said, and first thing you know, said, Jesus come. And so Martha put her little shawl on, and down the street she went, this young, beautiful girl. She ran down there. She said, Lord, look at that approach. She'd heard a sound one day. It was certain. She knew that there's something about him. She said, now where she went and said, we come out of our denomination because you preached against it. And we did all this because you did so-and-so. And we had faith in you. Now we're the talk of the town. Everybody's saying, where's your holy roller pastor at now? See? Something's in need. Where's that? He run off. See? Where's that? Where's them divine healers? Remember that was said by you, brother, right down there, by your Church of Christ preachers now? Yes, sir. Where is that? Where, why all about this? What about it now? You see? So after a while, it looked like she had a right to upbraid him and say something to him. Say, why didn't you come when I called? But see, that's not the way to approach God. Don't question. Know the sound certain. Walk on up to him. Yes, Lord. Lord, if they lay hands on me, how do I know I'm going to get well? It's none of your business. See? The only thing you do is just know that certain sound. Amen. That God said so.
Amen.
God said so. Yes, sir. It's God's word. Now, then, first thing you know, a little old Martha come running out there and she said, Lord! Oh, I like that. See, she titled him what he was. He was right. Lord, if thou would have been here, my brother would not have died. See? Said, even now, whatever you ask God, God will give it to you. Hey. Nothing uncertain about that.
Hallelujah.
See, that's when two positives meet. See? That's when two omnipotents meet. See? When one omnipotent, she had perfect omnipotent faith in Christ. And Christ was omnipotent.
Amen.
See? She had perfect infinite faith in Christ. That he was the Lord and knows whatever he asked God to give it to him. In other words, she said, you just speak the word. That's all you have to do. Whatever you ask God will give it to you. That's omnipotent. All powerful. Because he just said so. All right? And he was all powerful. That's when two powers, two omnipotent powers meets together. It's a contact then. When a line here's got 150 volts and this has got 150 volts, when they come together, you've got 150 volts both ways. See? And when you've got supreme power, when Jesus said, lay hands on the sick, they shall recover, and you got supreme faith, and that's being the truth, you need a supreme God that made a supreme promise and a supreme result will come.
Amen.
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 That's it. See? Now, watch her. She comes, she said, Lord, if thou would have been here, my brother would not have died. But even now, whatever you ask God, God will give it to you. He said, thy brother shall rise again. She said, truly, Lord, he'll raise in the last days. Why? She'd heard that word. She knew that was a certain sound. Sure, Lord, he'll raise in the last days. He's a good boy. He'll come up in the general resurrection of the last days. Jesus says, I am. Nothing uncertain about that. I am the both resurrection and life.
Praise the Lord. Hallelujah.
I am the resurrection and the life. He that believeth in me, though he were dead, yet shall he live.
Amen.
Whosoever liveth and believeth in me shall never die.
Amen.
Nothing uncertain about that. Believest thou this? She said, yea, Lord. I believe that you're just exactly what you said you were. You're the Son of God to come into the world to save us. And I believe that whatever you do or say is just perfect. There's no uncertainty about you at all. Where have you laid him? I'll go and wake him. Not I'll go and see if I can. I'll go and try. I'll go and see what I can do about it. No, nothing uncertain. I will go and awaken him.
Amen.
Why? The Father had told him. And he had the promise of God, which was true. He had the promise of God because he said in John 5:19 that the Son can do nothing in himself but what he sees the Father doing. He already had the vision of what God was going to do, so he had it positive. No one said, I won't go try, I'm going to do it.
Amen,
amen, amen, amen. Oh, I wish I could just take that like a corkscrew and twist it down into every person. See? Not I'll go try. I'll go see if I can. I will.
Amen.
I'll go and wake him. I won't go try. I'll go do it.
Yeah. I'll go and wake him. And he did.
Amen. Oh, my. Nothing uncertain. No, no. I'll not try. I've got the promise. And when he left now, he didn't leave us. You say, well, I'll tell you what. You all go into all the world and organize great organizations. And, oh, you're going to have several hundred of them, but they'll be all right. Now, that would be uncertain. That's what man done. But here's what he said before he left to be sure that we wouldn't be deceived. He said, a little while and the world won't see me no more.
Amen.
That's the unbelievers. That people's all stopped up with unbelief. They won't see me no more. Yet ye shall see me. For I will be with you, even in you, to the end of the world.
Amen.
John 14:12. He said, and the works that I do shall you do also. And greater works, and this shall you do, more of it. The word there, absolutely, look in the Greek, it says more shall you do. Because why? God was just in one man now. God's in his whole church.
Amen.
God was one man then. All men who are believing now. More than this shall you do, for I go to my Father. I return back to the light that I was that led the children of Israel through the wilderness. I'll turn back to that, and then in a little while, and I'll come again. See, John 14:12, the works that I do shall you do also. And now he said, and more than this, in Mark 16, when he's going away, he said, go ye into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature. He that believeth and is baptized shall be saved. He that believeth not shall be damned. And these signs shall, maybe, no, shall.
Amen.
They are certain.
Amen.
Well, you know, we believe that, but of course, we're living another day, says the denomination. That's uncertain. But Jesus said they shall, they'll certainly follow them that believe.
Amen.
Amen. What will they do? They'll cast out devils, speak with new tongues, lay hands on the sick. They shall recover.
Amen.
Oh, brother. Now, maybe they'll do this. They might change it, make a denomination out of it. No, no. These signs, well, they'll still be believers. Oh, no, no, no. These signs will certainly, they shall follow them.
Amen.
He's still the same God.
Amen.
He isn't dead. How can the Christian quote say that he raised from the dead and then deny him to be the same yesterday, today, and forever?
Hallelujah.
Now, in Matthew 17, if you all want to put it down, Matthew 17, Matthew 17, 2. You find out there on the Transfiguration. Now, if you got a Greek lesson, you look at there. On the Transfiguration, it said, and he was transformed. I believe that's, let me see if I got that just right now. Matthew 17, I got them all in here. Yes, after 6 days, Jesus taking Peter, James, and John, his brother, bringing them up to a high mountain, and was transfigured before them. Now, you know what the real Greek says he done? And transfigured before them, he changed his fashion. Oh, how much time have we got?
All day.
Just bear just a little bit. I just got to get this.
Amen.
Something that struck me so hard that I just got to say it. Forgive me. Now, the dinner, the beans won't scorch.
No.
And just let go. All right. He's still the same. He's never changed. He's still the same.
Amen.
Hebrews 13, 12, and 13 said Jesus Christ the same yesterday, today, and forever.
Amen.
Now look, if we believe that he resurrected, then if he is not dead, he's not in no grave, he's alive.
Amen.
He's the same yesterday, today, and forever. You believe that, don't
Amen.
You?
Amen.
Well, what did he do here when he was transfigured? The Greek says he changed his fashion.
Amen.
Oh. Look at the order of the resurrection. That's what struck me just then. Notice, what appeared first, back over here in the next chapter, the 16th chapter, he told them some standing there should not die until they've seen the kingdom of God coming in power. In other words, what would they do? They have seen the foretaste of the kingdom of God. They have known the order of the resurrection and the coming of God. See, in the 16th chapter. Now here he goes up there, and what happened? His fashion was changed. In other words, he was revealed in another way. Do you follow me?
Amen.
What do we find the revelation was the other night in the apocalypse? The apocalypse means a sculpture is dead back here making something. And then what he does, he just takes the curtain out and says, there it is.
Amen.
What was he doing here? He was revealing himself in another fashion.
What was he in? A glorified, transfigured condition. He's coming.
Amen.
The way he's coming, a glorified Christ.
Amen.
Transformed. His raiment shining like the sun. My. Oh, he stood in the cloud, and he's coming in the clouds of glory. Overshadowed by a cloud. Not a little white thunderhead up yonder, but the cloud that he comes in is a cloud of glory. All these angels with him. Hallelujah. Wow. That's where he's coming.
Amen.
Coming in a cloud of glory.
Amen.
Now, notice when they seen him standing there, and before that, there appeared to him Moses and Elijah. Watch what did Moses mean? Moses was represented the ones that had died. And was sleeping in the grave because Moses died and was buried. Nobody knew where he was buried at. But he represented the ones that were asleep when he come. And Elijah represented the translated ones who didn't have to die. And Peter, James, and John represented that remnant of Israel standing there saying, Lord, that's our God who we believe in. There's 144,000. Where you at, Brother Wood? That's it. See? There you are. Peter, James, and John, three a witness. To give, when he returns back, what was the first thing? The resurrection, Moses, and, conjunction, Elijah appeared to him. See, the resurrection of the dead, and the ones that don't have to die, was changed and was standing there in his presence.
Amen.
Oh, my.
Amen.
And there he stood glorified, and there was Peter, James, and John, the remnant of the Jews, looking to him. That's him.
Amen.
That's him. That's the order of the coming of the Lord.
Amen.
See it? There it is. The resurrection. There he was. Oh, isn't it wonderful? Now, notice the only thing he done, he took off his mask of humanity and become in a glorified state.
Amen.
See? He changed his fashion. Now, not three people as you try to say today, the denominations. Oh, brother, not three people. Not three change, not three people, but three changes of the same person.
Amen.
Amen.
Oh, my goodness. One time, he appeared as a father. He took off the mask. He was a son. Now he takes off the mask of flesh, and he's the Holy Ghost.
Amen.
Not three gods, three changes.
Amen.
Of the same God.
Glory.
Oh.
Hallelujah.
Blessed be the name of the Lord.
Amen.
Three changes of the same person. See? Now, when he was on earth, he was a pillar of fire, led the children of Israel. Is that right?
Amen.
Then he was made flesh. And the Son of God in order to taste death for the whole human race. Make an atonement. You believe that?
Amen.
Now what is he today? The same Jesus. The same what? Yesterday. In the fatherhood. Same in the sonship. Same here in the form of the Holy Spirit. Same life. Paul when he rode to Damascus was struck down by light and said, Who are you, Lord? Said, I'm Jesus. That's right. What is? Three times he took off his mask. Took off his mask from a pillar of fire. And become what? A man. To take away sin. Then took off his mask as a man and went back again to be a spirit called the Holy Ghost. The ghost of a man. To come back and be on you and in you and the very same works.
Amen.
Do you see it, church?
Amen.
There's nothing uncertain about that.
Amen.
The works that I do shall you also.
Yeah, amen.
For I will be with you, even in you.
Glory.
Ever. Until the end of the consummation, the end of the world, the end of the time, end of all things, I'll be right with you, doing the same works. Now, there's no uncertainty about that. But you hear some say, well, you must be a Presbyterian, you must be a Methodist, us Baptists have it, us Pentecostals have it. That's all wrong. That's lies. That's uncertain. How can Pentecost have it? The Pentecostal denomination was about 30 different organizations. Then which one is it? How can the Methodists have it when there's primitive and free Methodists and Methodists and non-Methodists and Methodists and 60-some-odd, I think, different organizations, the Baptists and so many different organizations, the Catholics and so forth? Where are they all at? Which one is it? That's uncertain sounds. But when you hear him, I'm the same yesterday, today, and forever. That's a certain sound. So who will know how to prepare themselves if the trumpet gives an uncertain sound? What is it? How can he do it? Well, there's 900 different organizations. All right, you can't do it. When he said in Acts 2:38, repent, every one of you, and be baptized in the name of Jesus Christ for the remission of your sins. There's no uncertain about that. Amen. You shall receive the gift of the Holy Ghost.
Amen.
Not maybe you will, perhaps you ought to, but you will.
Amen.
When? When you repented.
Amen.
Now you can go in there without repenting and you won't get it. But when you thoroughly repent and believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, you're going to get it.
Amen.
Nothing uncertain, you shall receive the gift of the Holy Ghost.
Amen.
Is that
Amen.
Right?
Amen.
When he said, if they lay hands on the sick, they shall recover.
Amen.
Whatever you ask in my name, I'll do it.
Amen.
Nothing uncertain, that's certain.
Amen.
These signs, I'll be with you. They say, well, our church don't believe in them kind of things. Well, it's just uncertain sound. The Bible says that he said himself, I'll be with you, and the works that I once did, I'll always do in you and be with you plumb to the end of the world.
Amen.
And those that believe in me, when they have hands laid on them, if they're sick, they shall recover.
Amen.
They shall. Not maybe they will. Jones did, but Johnson didn't. That don't have one thing to do with it. If Johnson believed like Jones, he would have recovered too.
Amen.
Is that right?
Amen.
Nothing uncertain. Nothing uncertain. He that comes
Amen.
To me, I will in no wise cast out. Nothing uncertain.
Amen.
Well, now, he might not receive me. Oh, you poor deluded person. Listen, let me tell you as his servant, there's no one can come to him but what he will receive.
Amen.
Though your sins be as scarlet, they shall be as white as snow.
Amen.
Nothing uncertain. I'll forgive part of them. Maybe you've done this, you've done that, and I'll hold against you. They shall be white as snow. Well, he won't
Amen.
Forgive me for what I've done to my husband, what I've done to my wife, what I've done to my sister, what I've done to my brother, what I did. I don't care what you've done. There's nothing uncertain. He'll forgive everything.
Amen.
Though they be red as crimson, they'll be white like wool.
Amen.
Nothing uncertain. Repent and be baptized, everyone, in the name of Jesus Christ for the remission of sins. You shall receive the gift of the Holy Ghost.
Amen.
Promise isn't to you, your children. Them as far off. Now watch now. Watch you, extreme Trinitarians. Even as many as the Lord our God shall call. This same prescription. It'll work through every time. Now it may be. It'll change after a while. The Father, Son, Holy Ghost. You poor deluded teacher.
Amen.
God cannot change. He's
Amen.
Infinite.
Amen.
Prescription works every time that you give it in the right way.
Yes,
yes sir. Now, repent and be baptized in the name of Jesus Christ for the remission of sins. You shall receive the Holy Ghost, for it is, what? This prescription, this baptism, this form of baptism, this Holy Ghost, this same power. Not just shake hands and say, I'll turn a new leaf and do better. No, sir, you shall receive the gift of the Holy Ghost, the power of God.
Amen.
Change your ways, speak in tongues, lay hands on the sick, cast out devils, do the same as they did. For how many, how long? To the end of the disciples. You are a false prophet if you say that. You're a false teacher if you say that. For Jesus Christ, the Bible teaches us that he's the same yesterday and forever. And the apostle said here that the promise is unto you and to your children and to them as far off, even, saith with me, even as many as the Lord our God shall call.
Hallelujah.
How many? Every age, every generation, every color, every creed, every whatever it is, as many as God calls. If God calls you, commands you to be baptized in the name of Jesus Christ and receive the Holy Ghost, then Christ himself lives in you, and there's no uncertain sound. No uncertainty of it. You've got the Bible.
Amen.
Oh, you stand on it. You can live on it. You can die on it.
Amen.
You'll rise on it.
Amen.
Glory to God's word.
Amen.
Wow. Like Rebecca who watered the camel. The very camel that she watered, she rode on it to meet her bride.
Amen.
The very God that we preach about, the very word which is God.
Yes.
The very God that's in the word will rise us up someday by the baptism of the Holy Ghost. And our critics will be killed by the same power that raised you to glory.
Amen.
Oh, my. Rise up and ride on it. You people are sick. Don't you disbelieve God. Did Leo and them, I don't know where they, did he give out any prayer cards? Is any prayer cards give out? Billy didn't come this morning. He got a cold yesterday and he all right. Now, what, we won't need it. We won't need it. Listen. Do you believe what I preach to be the truth?
Amen.
Do you believe with all your heart?
Yes, sir.
Is it a certain sound to you?
Yes, sir.
How does this sound? The first commission Jesus gave Matthew 10 to his church. Go ye and these, I am not reading it, I'm just quoting it, Matthew 10. I can get it here. He called his 12 apostles together and gave them power against unclean spirits to cast out evil spirits, to heal the sick, and to raise the dead, and to cast out devils, and to cure the leprosy. Is that right?
Yeah.
By getting people to believe it and then laying hands on them. Getting people to believe it and then laying hands on them.
Amen.
Getting people to believe it and laying hands on them. Was that his first commission when he sent his 70?
Yes, sir.
What was the last commission he gave? Mark 16. Last words that fell from our Lord's lips when he commissioned his church, go into all the world, preach the gospel to every creature. He that believeth and is baptized shall be saved. He that believeth not shall be damned. Now remember, he may be damned. He might have a chance. He won't have one earthly chance.
Amen.
No uncertain sound about that. If you don't believe, he'll be damned.
Amen.
Now, what kind of signs go to follow then? These signs, well, on some of them it'll follow. Perhaps it will. Maybe it will. These signs shall follow
Amen.
Them.
Amen.
They'll believe in healing. They'll believe in casting out devils.
Amen.
They'll believe in speaking with tongues.
Yes, sir.
Oh, they'll believe in all the supernatural
yes,
works
sir.
Of God.
Amen.
The resurrected Jesus working
yes,
with them.
Sir.
Is that the truth?
Yes,
is that God's last word?
Amen. Yes, sir.
Then cursed is he that tries to add to or take away.
Yes, sir.
Hallelujah.
Yes, sir.
That's the way it is. Was the Pentecostal church a noisy church? Back at the beginning? When the Holy Ghost first fell? The Virgin Mary, like she was drunk,
Holy.
Staggering under the power of God and all of them like that, and the people said, they're full of new wine. That's the way the church was ordained. That's the way the ever church is ordained. Every time God has a church, it'll be that same kind of church. Because it ain't got no uncertain stuff. Well, our bishop says, I don't care what the bishop says, what the word says. That bishop's got an uncertain sound. If his sound is sounding the same thing this is, he's right. And then if the church don't act like it did like that, he's wrong. If you say you got it and didn't act like that, then there's something wrong with you. Because that's exactly what it says. Everyone. Isaac went out to the house. Philip went out preaching to the Samaritans, laid hands on them. Paul come down, or Peter came down, laid hands on them. They received the Holy Ghost, done the same thing they did at the beginning. Went up to the house of Cornelius, and there's all the Gentiles up there, the Greeks and so forth. Laid hands upon them. They received the Holy Ghost like they did at the beginning. Let me tell you something. I'm a missionary. You know, now, I believe a missionary is the guy that goes and comes. That's the missionary. If you go there to stay, they call that a missionary, but that's a homesteader. You just change your residency. That's not a missionary. A missionary, Paul was a missionary. He didn't stay. He just kept going and going and going. A missionary. Not change residence. Just keep going. A missionary. Now, in the missionary field, I'll tell you, down into the lowest regions of Africa, down to the little old bushmen, and they didn't even know where they were human or not. For a long time, the British government, when they take over South Africa, you go into a little jungle and you see the bushes shake like a bunch of monkeys and look around, there ain't nothing. And happen to push up through the sand, you see a little black head looking around. See? He had buried himself in the sand, right, and scratched the sand over him real quick. They didn't think they thought they were animals for a long time. But you know how they found out they were human? They had dogs, and a dog won't live with nothing but a human being. See?
Amen.
And they found out that they were human. And take one of those little fellows, and take one of the bazoodas, the Shungai, Kozai, any of those tribes, don't even know which is right and left hand. Always never blah, 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 you know, and talking like that, naked women, men and all. I'll tell you what you do. You just let the Holy Ghost fall on you. And he'll do the same thing you do right here when the Holy Ghost falls on you. There's no uncertain sound about it. You never heard such a thing as speaking in tongues in his life? And he's speaking in tongues to you. But here stands the interpreter. This guy stands there and says, blah. You want me to say, blah, blah, yeah. If somebody up there, blah, 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 blah. Raise up your hands and receive, blah, blah. Oh, my, here he goes. Speaking in tongues, never heard of it.
Hallelujah.
Know nothing about it. There's no uncertainty about that.
Amen.
That's Jesus Christ the same yesterday.
Praise
the Lord. Watch him, he'll go right into the tribes and go to praying for the sick. You don't have to tell him.
Right.
And we American women, you church members, I'm not talking so much you here, this is taped, you know. You church members out there wearing shorts and carrying on the way you are. Every year you take a little bitty off and you have shorts and then shorty shorts and then shorty shorts and shorty shorts and all like that. Well, you poor, deluded church member, you're worse than you are in Africa.
Amen.
When them women stood right there that day when 30,000 received Christ as their personal Savior at one time, and you sing in choirs and wear shorts in the yard to cut your grass in downtown, you are worse than they are, and you'll They'll rise in the day of judgment and make you ashamed of yourself.
Amen.
I've seen women standing there as naked, didn't have nothing but a little patch over the front of them like that, and up in their parts here, their bust parts, nothing at all, and just one little strap about 4 or 6 inches a little around their waist like this hanging in front of them. And a man too standing there totally naked, didn't know right and left hand. And as soon as the power of the Holy Ghost come, them women folded their arms, nothing to cover their bosom over, folded their arms in shame and walked away. And the next day they had clothes on.
Hallelujah.
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 There's no uncertainty about that. The Holy Spirit makes you put on clothes. Makes you act decent. Nothing uncertain about that. Don't you want Him? Wouldn't you love to serve someone like that? The Lord Jesus? Get away from these uncertain sounds. Oh, you're a pauper little thing. Yeah, all fixed up and everything. You think you're a pauper, but honey, you're dying.
Amen.
You think you're living, you're dying. The Bible said the woman that lives in pleasure is dead while she's alive.
Amen.
The Bible said that. That's no uncertain sound. It says she's dead.
Yeah.
That's right. No uncertain sound about it. It's certainty, brother. God is a holy God. And when a man is born to the Holy Spirit, he's a candidate. He's not only that, but he's a king. He's a prince. He's from another nation. His kingdom is above. He's filled with God's power, God's presence. The woman that does that puts on clothes. The man lives decent and true to his wife. The wife lives true and decent to their husband. They want nothing of the world. Their affections are set on things above. They're finished with the things of the world. They are new creatures in Christ, and they're holy. Live it. Not them holy, but the Holy Spirit's governing them. They don't have their own mind. The Holy Spirit moves in them. That's the reason they act crazy to the people of the world. Because they're moved by a spirit of another kingdom. Oh, I know it so, friend.
Amen.
I was once lost, but now I'm found.
Amen.
I was blind to those things, but now I see.
Amen.
It was grace that taught my heart to fear. It was grace my fears relieved. How precious did that grace appear in the hour I first believed.
Amen.
When I come to Christ, now in closing, for both salvation and for healing, let me say these words just for a minute. Paul Rader was a friend of mine. I knew him just a little while. I was just a boy, sat at his feet. Great minister that died here not long ago in California. And when he was dying, he took cancer and was dying out there in California. The tabernacle now, O.L. Jaggers has. He had it up there, the old, I forget what the name of it was called then, but it's the World Church now. Paul Rader's old tabernacle. And it's up off of Alvarado Street, as you go up towards, cross over to McPherson's Temple, just across the way there at the park. Now, and when Paul Rader was pastoring that, they got out there, and when before he died, he put his hands on a brother's shoulder that I know real well, a friend of Ern Baxter, and said, if I would have took my message of grace and sold it to the red-hot Pentecostals, and instead of trying to fool you bunch of Baptists, I've been living today. But said, you have worried me, and I've got so tore up and all such a fixed up. Now I'm dying. So we laid in the room there. They pulled down the blinds and things, and they were standing there singing, "Near my God to thee." And he had a sense of humor. He said, "Who's dying? Me or you? You sound more like you're dying than I am." He said, "Don't do that. Sing me some real snappy gospel songs." And a little quartet from Moody Bible Institute began to sing, "Pound at the cross where my Savior died." He said, "That sounds better. Praise God."
Amen.
So where's Luke? And Luke and Paul stuck together just like Billy and I, my son. They were brothers. And they stuck together. So where's Luke? And Luke didn't want to see his brother die. He's in the next room there at the hospital. They go get him and tell him to come here. And when he come over to where Paul was, Paul reached over and got his hand. Luke tried to turn his head. He said, "Luke, we've been through a many hard battle together, haven't we, brother?" He said, "Yes, we have. Through these years we've toiled, brother." "That's right. Many hard battles." But said, "Luke, think of it. In 5 minutes from now, I'll be standing in the presence of Jesus Christ, clothed in His righteousness." Squeezed his brother's hands and died. There's nothing uncertain about that.
Amen.
He knew the way he was going. He knew he had the baptism of the Holy Ghost. Power of God in his life. He used to be a logman. And he cut down trees and things and said, he is missionary too, like I go over in the seas. And he and Luke and them was down in the island. They took black water fever, if anyone knows what that is. It's death. It's really bad. So he took black water fever. He's way back in the jungles where there's nothing. Him and his lovely little wife was there. You know how he said, I told you a story, how he said the last time had a feeling to it when she kissed him goodbye. And so they were back there, and it got kept getting dark, darker in the room. He said he knew he was going, or he thought he was. And he told his wife, said, honey, it's getting so dark in here. He said, I'm dying. And she said, oh, Paul, Paul. And she fell on her face and began crying. He said, honey, just keep crying. Keep crying out to God and let me hear your voice. Let somebody pray. I can't pray anymore. Said, well, I'm dying. I want to hear it. And she kept crying out to God, oh, God, don't let him die. His work isn't finished yet. Keep crying. Oh, God, please don't let Paul die. She was laying across him like that. Got darker and darker. He said, darling, it's getting darker and darker and darker and darker. Finally, he passed out. He said, when I passed out, I dreamed. And I was a young man again. Said I was up in the forest up in Oregon where he come from. Said I fell a tree. The boss said told me, go up there on top of the hill, Paul, and I want you to fell a certain tree. And it was so much, and we got to make some timber. And said, he said, all right, boss. And said, he could smell him, how fresh it was and how good he felt. Said he's run up through the forest like that, and he tuck his axe and said he could feel that old axe bit going to that soft pine, you know, that Oregon pine. And said when it went down in there, you know, down south they have that same tree, it's real hard. You go up north, and the colder you get, the softer the wood gets. Said he could find, so he tuck his axe and run across with that old double bit and scraped all the limbs off of it. Said he stuck the axe in there, said, well, I'll go right down the hill with it. He got a hold of it and said he just couldn't lift it. He just couldn't lift it. He said he tried and he tried. He said he remembered that a man's best muscles is in his back. So he said he put his knees together so he wouldn't rupture himself. And he stooped over and got a hold of it and tucked his knees, muscles in the back of the legs, up here, the calf of the legs, in his arms, in his back, put all of his muscle to it. And said he pulled and he pulled and he just couldn't. He said, just pull. Until he tried and tried, said, I've got to get this log down there. I just got to. The boss ordered it down there, and I've got to get it there. Well, I said, usually, I don't know where my strength's all gone. So, well, I could have put that thing on my shoulder and walked with it. I said, but I just can't get it up. He tried and he tried and he tried. He said, he just couldn't do it. He just wore himself out. He said, he just fell down against the tree. He said, I've just toiled and I've toiled. I've toiled and I've toiled till I just can't go no farther. And I've got to get that log down there, but don't know how I can do it. I can't lift it. Said, just sitting there, said, he said, I just don't know what to do. And said, he heard his voice of his boss say, Paul. And said, it was the sweetest voice he ever heard. And said, when I turned to look, said, it wasn't my boss, but it was my real boss.
Amen.
It was Jesus. He said, what you toiling at it for, Paul? Said, you see that stream going there? Said, that stream goes right to the camp. So I want you to just push it in the water and ride on it.
Amen.
Go on down. So he said he just took the log and rolled it in the water and jumped on it. Went over them ripples, just a hollering and a screaming. Said, I'm riding on it. I'm riding on it. And said when he come to in the room, his wife leaned over and praying, he jumped up in the middle of the floor hollering, I'm riding on it. I'm riding on it. Brother, let me tell you something this morning. Don't toil at it. I'm not trying to toil at it. It'll wear you out. Back and forth, am I a Methodist, am I a Baptist, am I this? I just received Jesus. I took his promise by grace. He comes to me, and I'm riding on it. I don't care what happens or what goes, how many times we're called crazy or fanatic. On your healing this morning, when we're prayed for, we ain't going to have time not to go on 1 o'clock for a line of discernment. We're going to pray for the sick and get and pray for everyone here. Jesus said, these signs shall follow them that believe. Is that right? If they lay their hands on the sick, they shall recover.
Amen.
Is that right?
Amen.
I'm riding on it.
Amen.
Are you ready to ride on it?
Yes.
Let's bow our heads just a moment. Gracious God, oh, these last days, when the hours are getting dark, the church has rolled around the Word, and they've twisted to denominations, and they know that's not right, Lord. May they just stop twisting it. There's probably people here this morning, it's went from church to church. One time they was in a Methodist, and then in a Baptist, and then a Pentecostal, and then a Church of God, then a Nazarene. Oh God, may they just stop doing that. May they just come right on the promise this morning, Lord. Just relax. Take God at His promise. when he said, if you repent and are baptized in the name of Jesus Christ for the remission of your sins, you shall receive the gift of the Holy Ghost. God grant that they can just ride on that promise this morning. Just fall right into the ocean of His goodness, the sprays of everlasting life, the water of the Spirit. Grant it, Lord. May the Holy Spirit that's running, rippling freshly right by their door now, may they just step over in the stream on the promise of God and say, Lord, I'm riding on it. Here I come. I'm riding on it. May the sick and afflicted that's sick and don't know what to do, the doctors give them up. They've wrestled from hospital to hospital, from door to door, from place to place. They don't know what to do, Lord. But the stream of life rolling right by them this morning. May they take that scripture, Mark 16. If they lay their hands on the sick, they shall recover. The believers will recover when they have hands laid on them. Lord, may they just take that in consideration this morning. Step on it and say, Lord, here I am. I don't know how I'm going to go, but I'm riding on it. I'm going right down the streams, rejoicing, splashing my hands in the waters of life, throwing it into my soul and up over my head and bathing myself in your goodness and rejoicing as I go, riding on your promise that you said they shall recover. Grant it, Father. Now, with our heads bowed, I wonder if there is a person in this building this morning. How many in this building this morning that doesn't know Christ as your Savior, and you believe that the stream of life has been brought to you? You've had all kinds of uncertain sounds. You've built your house up on things that sinking sand. You realize that someday you're going to die. You're going out of this world. And you really want to hear a certain sound, and you believe you heard it this morning, that Christ still loves you. I don't care how sinful you are, He still loves you. And you would like for me to remember you in prayer. And right where you're standing, we can't call you here at the altar. There's no altar because it's full of children and so forth. But you believe that you want to accept Christ just now as your personal Savior. And you want me to remember you in a word of prayer. Will you raise your hand? You say, I now, God bless you, God bless you, God bless you, God bless you, God bless you. Way back, God bless you. Up here in the middle, down on this side, God bless you. I now accept Christ as my personal Savior. I want Him to be good to me. God bless you. Way back in the back, way back in the aisles. See you back there. God bless you. Would there be another? Raise up your hand, no matter where you are, heads bowed. God bless you, young lady. God bless you back there, sister. God bless you back there, sister. You didn't have your hand up, but I went to see your husband last night. As they're in a hospital, real bad, from up there at the brother's church. Don't worry, you'll be all right. The Lord touched him right there last night. I seen what was wrong with him. The doctors has tried for 4 days to find it, but they couldn't find nothing but the x-ray. But the Holy Spirit goes deeper than an x-ray. So, God, it's all right. You'll be home now. You maybe come home today. All right, someone else. Got way back in the back. God bless you. I want to accept Christ as personal Savior. I want to be ready to. I know the uncertainty of my home. I know the uncertainty of my job. I know the uncertainty of my life. I don't know what time I'm going to die. I may die yet today. I don't know. It's uncertain. But I want a certain sound. I believe I heard it today through the gospel that Jesus Christ loves me, and I want to accept Him as my personal Savior. Someone who hasn't lifted their hands and want to do it. God bless you. God bless you. All right, someone else, lift your hands that never has lifted it before. Lift your hands. Say, remember me, Brother Branham, in prayer. God bless you. All right. Heavenly Father, there has been a certain sound that these people have heard. Many of them here, literally many, that has this morning accepted you as their personal Savior. Now, Father, I know it's traditional to bring people up to an altar to pray, but it isn't scriptural, because the Scripture said as many as believed on Him were baptized. So I pray, Father, that these who have believed on You, that You revealed Yourself to them in that certain sound of a voice that they know it's You. And they want You for Savior. They raised up their hand for me to remember them in a word of prayer. Oh God, knowing that the hours is closing, lights are going out now, the light of civilization is going out, the light of America is going out, the light of the nations is going out, for the light of the world is coming in. I pray, God, that you let them receive this great light. We realize that no darkness can exist in the presence of light. Light is so much stronger than darkness. And let them know that about 10 hours ago, this building was as dark as it could be. You could not see a seat. It was midnight dark in this building 10 hours ago, but the sun rose. Where'd that darkness go? Find it for me. They cannot find it. Where's the chemistry of it? What happened to it? It cannot be found. It's gone. So is their sins now. Where 20 minutes ago, darkness was in their soul. But they've accepted you as their Savior now, and the darkness is all expelled.
Amen.
Your sins that were many have been purged, and now they're as white as snow.
Yeah.
You cannot find them no more. They're off of the book. They're off of the record. The blood of Jesus Christ forgive them of their sins. May they in return rise and be baptized tonight in the name of Jesus Christ, calling upon the name of the Lord, and receive the Holy Ghost. Granted, Father, I commit them to you as the trophies of the message this morning, in the name of Jesus Christ, thy Son. Now, with your heads bowed, each one of you raise your hand. If you have not been baptized yet, in the name of Jesus Christ, the church will have services tonight. And make ready now. Let the pastor put your name down now this morning. Your baptism, that's not this morning, is it, brother? Yeah, baptizing this morning, immediately after this service. Baptism will come right on up. We got clothes ready for you to be baptized in the name of Jesus Christ. You are a Christian now. The light of God's come to your heart. Remember how good that is. Jesus said, no man can come to me except my Father draws him. Why'd you raise your hand? Because something told you to. The same one told you to made the promise. He that heareth my words and believeth on him that sent me has everlasting life. No uncertainty about it. You have everlasting life now. If you believe that with all your heart, you've now passed from death to life. You're living forevermore. Now receive His Holy Spirit, the power of God to work in your life and to make you work for Him. May you receive it this morning as you're baptized in the name of Jesus Christ.
Amen.
To those who are sick and wants to be prayed for, I want to see the number so I can see where they would raise your hand. See how many, where they have a line of discernment of, it's too many. We just have to pray for them. It's too many. It's 150, 200 people to be prayed for. All right. How many has ever seen the discernment? Raise your hand.
Amen.
All of you. That's right. So you know what it is. Now, do you believe this morning that you've heard the voice of God? Now, I'm going to ask for Brother Wood, Brother Fred Softman, and some of the trustees to come here just a moment.
Amen.
Some of you trustee brothers or deacons or whatever, come here just a moment. Now, it's going to be rather congested here, and I want you to help. Now, to you, you people on this, my right side, that's going to be prayed for, I want you to come on this side here. And Brother Collins, stand right down in there, if you will. And come right down here so they can come by and be prayed for. I'm going to ask you little children on this side of the altar if you'll go over on this side just for a few minutes for Brother Branham. Not for me, but for the Lord Jesus.
Amen.
Now you brothers stand here so that the people can come right through. And then we'll take all on this other side. Now from this first row right here, Brother Charlie, I wonder if you, Brother David, if you want to come up here or move kind of back towards the back, all right? Now, the first ones here in this row, just raise up like that and start from that side over and against the wall as we pray. Now, when we get ready to start, now not yet. Now, on this side over here, we'll have you all to go back to this side and then go out to that side and then come down. Now, the trustees and them will get you in the right position. Now, if that lady's crippled and can't get up, and like the little girl here in the chair, now you sit right where you are. I'll come right to you. And I know little Edith, she's back there, and we'll bring her right up here. Those who cannot get up, I'll come to you. Now, what good would it do us to stand here and speak? What good would it do us to preach this word of God if you don't hear it?
Yeah.
He that heareth and believeth. He that heareth. Are you ready? Are each one of you ready to confide yourself to God and say, that is God's Word? Now, I don't care what my state is after I'm prayed for, I'm healed anyhow. Will you believe it? Now, a lot of people are looking for something, you know, like what if that woman, when I prayed for her on the back steps back there, I looked down at her, and then that taking place, what if she said, well, first month passed, well, I'm growing bigger all the time. See? No, not her. She heard a voice. That voice told her. And she believed it with all of her heart. And the tumor, after a while, went right on down, and now she's normal and well. Leo, where are you at? Is he here somewhere? I forget what that lady's name is. Probably somebody would... I've got her address. I'll bring it down to church. You, what do you remember her name? Is it Redford or Redford? We got her name and address. You'd like to write. She was healed right there with a tumor weighed over 30 pounds. Not a scratch on her from a knife. There's her picture when she had the tumor. Here she is now without a scratch anywhere. God healed her and took it away from her. There's doctor statements where he'd give her up to die with cancer eating her kidneys out. And now she's normal and well without any kidney trouble at all. She's one of the tens of thousands.
Amen.
What is it? Not an uncertain sound.
Amen.
But the thing of it is, friend, can you hear it?
Amen.
Now if the trumpet gives an uncertain sound, say, well, some gets healed and some don't. That's uncertain. Okay? Don't believe that. Jesus said, whosoever, that's certain.
Amen.
These signs shall follow them that believe.
Amen.
They have hands laid on them, they shall recover. You believe that now?
Amen.
With all your heart, you believe it. And I'm going to ask the pastor, now we got a baptismal service following this. So see, then we won't have too much time, but I'm going to pray for the congregation, for every sick person in here. And when I come by, I'm going, you believe me to be a servant?
Yes. Amen.
Well, if you believe that, then the anointing of the Holy Spirit will come right into you.
Amen. Mm-hmm.
It has to, friend.
Amen.
I'm not saying, it's nothing me, I'm your brother. I'm the least one among you. But that's what I have to be. Let him that's least among you, let me be servant of all of you, see? That's what I want to be. I'm your servant. You're God's child. I'm just his servant. I'm trying to serve you, you see? I'm the littlest one. Nothing about me, but see, somebody's got to lay hands on you.
Amen.
And being that he let me bring the word, and you believe the word come to me, so many of you call me a believer, and then the word comes to me, you judge yourself whether it's right or not.
Amen.
Let God do the judging by his word. Well, if that's so, then ever promise is so.
Amen.
It has
Amen.
To be.
Yes.
See? Noah, he just kept building on the ark. He said he's a fanatic. There's nothing up there. How are you going to get that? Don't make any difference. God can put it up there. And he kept on hammering away. Who else I spoke of? Moses. How was Moses going down there to take over that army? How's he going to take over all of Egypt? How can he do it? One old man, 80 years old, his wife, a child. How's he going to do it? That's not my business. God said, go take it over, and I'm going down.
Amen.
How are you going to deliver him out of Pharaoh's hands? Surely I'll be with you. Nothing uncertain. These signs shall follow them that believe. Nothing uncertain. If you believe it, have hands laid on you, you've got to get well. You believe that with all your heart?
Yes.
Now I want every person in here that can pray. I want you to bow your head. I want you to pray silently. I'm going to pray for these claws, man, here because I feel the presence of the Lord.
Hallelujah.
Heavenly Father, we're fixing to close one service and enter another. Many have received you, Lord, this morning. Many hands went up. They passed from death unto life. That little slow moment, it passed by. A little light passed by. A little smother come over their conscience. What was it? They were dying. And they passed then from death unto life. Like a grain of corn falls into the ground. First thing it smothers out, it dies, rots away. Then a little spring of life comes from it, and it produces another corn. Now, Lord, this morning, a little smother of death passed over them. And when it did, they woke in a few moments when they raised their hands, feeling themselves smothered down by the word of God, something saying, you're condemned, you're a sinner, you'll die and go to hell, you'll perish, you'll never rise again. That's death coming up on them. Finally, they died to that spot. So they heard a voice say, but I am your Savior. Come unto me, all you labor and heavy laden. And they raised their hands. I want to accept him as my personal Savior. And then a spring of life come into their soul. They sprung up again to bring forth another Christian. God, may they go to the water now before the audience, be baptized in Jesus Christ's name for the remission of their sins. To let the people see that they thoroughly have sold out to the things of the world and go to serve Christ from now on, for they are dead and buried with Him in baptism, to rise to new life, to walk in a new life. Here's many handkerchiefs I'm holding in my hands, Lord. They represent sick people. Now, in the Bible one time, as I've often quoted this, when Israel was in the path of duty, going over to the Promised Land, the Red Sea got in their way. God looked down through them clouds with angered eyes through the pillar of fire, and that Red Sea got scared because God had made a promise. No uncertain sound. The sea knowed that God's word wasn't unsound. They knew it was certain. Israel was bound for that Promised Land. Nothing could stand in their way because God had said so. So the sea got scared, moved back, made a dry path right through the middle of it, and they walked across on dry land. Now there's many Christians that are sick, Lord. Here's their handkerchief. They say in the Bible that they took off the body of Paul, handkerchiefs of Aaron. We know we're not St. Paul, but we know that you're still the same God with the same word and the same promise. When I send these handkerchiefs to them sick and afflicted, may that devil that's got them bound get scared and move back.
Amen.
May the children of God walk out to the promise of good health. Grant it, Lord. Now, many of them are in this building. Here is your pastor this morning, my brother Neville. Here is your deacons and trustees standing here, ordained man of this church, that you are so graciously blessing, though we're unworthy, Lord. But we see your spirit moving among us. And we're so happy for this. Looked like a revival moving out for the last time. Oh, God, we sold out to Egypt now. We're on our road to the Promised Land. Just a few days' journey now, and we'll be crossing over Jordan. And now, Father God, we pray that you'll move every obstacle in our way. Many of these people are not in marching condition. They are here because they're sick and afflicted. How can that sickness hold them, people? How can those afflictions keep them crippled and in wheelchairs when they're on the march to the Promised Land?
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. God, when we apply our hands to their body, may the devil get scared and move back. May they be in marching condition. I'm thanking you for that woman I've been talking about all morning. Can't get her off my mind to see that woman. Couldn't even stand up with that big tumor. Doctors making fun of her. But she'd heard a voice. It wasn't uncertain. It was a certain sound. And she believed it. Now, Lord, may every sick person in here saying that, hear that same sound this morning and be in marching condition to leave, Lord, for the journey. Grant it, Lord. We got everything packed up now. Oh, we're ready to march, Lord. We're ready for the wilderness and across Jordan, yonder. Just a few days' journey and we'll be there. God, let us go in the power of the Holy Ghost. May we ever be present when we see that light shining out, our Lord leading the way, that resurrected Christ shining to that perfect day. Grant it, Father. Now, as we anoint our hands, anoint us, that the Holy Spirit that's in us now will shine forth the cosmic lights, the light of God shine forth into them sick, weak bodies, and every one of them be healed. We come forward, Lord, to meet the devil. We come forward to meet the Red Sea, that as it was, the Red Sea, that's the sea of sickness that's holding these people back from marching. We come forward with the Holy Ghost shining before us.
Amen.
To meet the devil in the name of Jesus Christ. That sickness will have to move back.
Hallelujah.
Because you look down through the power of your word and they have to recover. We come in Jesus' name to meet the enemy.
Amen.
Amen.
Thank you.